TV 38 Sports presents Boston Red Sox Baseball. Brought to you in part by the 9X Yellow Pages. If it's out there, it's in here. By Diet Pepsi, the right one, baby. Uh-huh. By your local participating McDonald's restaurant for good food and good value. By Bud Light, everything else is just a light. And by the Boston Globe. Have you seen the Globe today? It is a partly cloudy and cool afternoon at Fenway Park as the Red Sox prepare to play their 80th home opener at Fenway Park. They'll begin their home season with the Cleveland Indians. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to what is a very special day on the annual sports calendar in New England, opening day at Fenway Park. I'm Sean McDonald along with Bob Montgomery. We are delighted to have you with us. Monty, this is a special day. The Red Sox return home. Having lost 2 out of 3 to the Toronto Blue Jays, they'll play the Cleveland Indians today. Cleveland also 1-2. They played in Kansas City to start the year. What about this Cleveland club?
Sean, both these ball clubs were involved in some close ball games, and the Cleveland Indians, under the direction of John McNamara, feels that his pitching is going to be strong enough that they're going to be involved in a lot of close games all year long. Consequently, not so much power on this Cleveland ball club, but they are speedy, very speedy.
The Indians struggled to score runs in their series with Kansas City. They scored just 4 runs in the 3 ball games against the Royals. Eric King will start today for Cleveland. For the Red Sox, it'll be Danny Darwin making his Boston debut. Now let's meet today's starting lineups. Here's public address announcer Sherm Feller.
Boys and girls.
Welcome to the home opener of the Boston Red Sox 91st American League season. And welcome also to the Red Sox opponent today, the Cleveland Indians. Leading the Indians is the manager, number one, John McNamara. And today's Indian batting order. Leading off, number two, center fielder Alex Cole. Number 14, second baseman Jerry Brown. Number nine, third baseman Carlos Baerga. Number eight, the left fielder Albert Bell. Number 15, catcher Sandy Alomar. Number 26, first baseman Brooke Jacoby. Number 7, the designated hitter Chris James. Number 16, the shortstop Felix Vermeen. Number 20, right fielder Turner Ward. And the pitcher, warming up in the right field bullpen, number 40, Eric King. And the rest of the 1991 Cleveland Indians. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the defending Eastern Division champion, 1991 Boston Red Sox. Leading the Red Sox is our manager, number 35, Joe Morgan. And today's Red Sox batting order, leading off, number 26, the third baseman, Wade Boggs. Number 3, second baseman, Jody Reed. Number 39, left fielder, Mike Greenwell. Number 25, designated hitter, Jack Clark. Number 12, Ellis Burke. Number 22, 3. The right fielder, Tom Bernanke. Number 18, first baseman, Carlos Quintana. Number 6, the catcher, Tony Pena. And number 11, the shortstop, Tim Neary. And the pitcher, warming up in the bullpen, right in center field, number 44, Danny Darwin. Now in numerical order, the rest of the Red Sox, number 2, infielder Louis Rivera. Number 5, outfielder Randy Cutcher. Number 15, pitcher Dennis Lamp. Number 16, outfielder Kevin Romine. Number 19, pitcher Dana Kicker. And number 20, catcher John Marzano. Number 21, the pitcher Roger Clemens. 22. Infielder Mike Marshall. Number 27. Pitcher Greg Harris. Number 30. Pitcher Matt Young. Number 32. Coach Richie Hebner. Number 33, Coach Dick Berardino. In the Red Sox bullpen, number 34, Coach Bill Fisher. Number 36, Coach John McLaren. Number 37, Coach Al Bumbry. Number 38, pitcher Jeff Gray. Number 41, pitcher Jeff Rinn. Number 48, pitcher Tony Fonten. Number 50, the pitcher Tom Bolton. Number 55, pitcher Joe Heska. And number 60, Coach Bill Maloney. Now the Red Sox trainer, Charlie Moss. Physical therapist, Rich Zawacki. And Red Sox equipment manager, Don Fitzpatrick. Let's hear it now. Nice hand. For both these teams. Please direct your attention to the area behind the second base. For the Navy ROTC unit, Boston University will present today's colors under the direction of Chief Petty Officer Stephen Schaefer. Now, ladies and gentlemen, please rise as we honor America. For the National Anthem, sung by Richard Franco, accompanied by Jeff Sargent, Daniel Fisher, on the synthesizer of a 215th Army Band of the Massachusetts Army National Guard. Guard.
festivities from Fenway Park in a moment.
Who can you trust these days to take care of your car when it starts shaking?
Or pulling, or rattling.
Or squeaking.
Or suspension or alignment? Nobody beats Midas.
I worry about something I can't see.
What your eyes can't see, our state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment will show you. Whatever the problem, we keep it from getting bigger. So for alignment shocks or struts, nobody beats Midas. Nobody.
Buy any Midas shock or strut until April 27th and get the second one for 50% off installed.
Shine a light on you, shine a light on me. Keep your Bud Light shining for everyone to see.
When you're looking good, you want Bud Light. The clean, fresh taste won't fill you up and never let you down.
Show the spirit. Show the pride. Bruins pride. The Boston Bruins face off with the Hartford Whalers in Game 6 of the Adams Division semifinals, Saturday night at 7:30 on TV 38.
We're back live at Fenway Park in Boston, where the Indians and Red Sox are standing by to meet in the Fenway home opener. For more pregame festivities, let's rejoin public address announcer Sherm Feller.
Ladies and gentlemen, today's ceremonial first pitch to open the 1991 home season will be thrown out by Brigadier General Richard I. Neal. General Neal, a native of Hull, Massachusetts, played a significant role as the leader of troops in Operation Desert Storm. Is familiar to most American citizens for his highly visible briefing regarding coalition forces during the recent successful campaign in the Persian Gulf. General Neal, let's hear it.
Well, we've watched a lot of ceremonial first pitches here at Fenway Park. I'm not sure I've ever heard any of the honorees so welcomed, and it was touching to watch members of both teams come up to the top step of their dugout to applaud and pay tribute to General Neal and all the people he represents who did such a wonderful job.
It'll take the rest of this game to get these goosebumps to go away for me. I don't know about you.
Well said. Today's opening day starting lineups are brought to you by your New England Ford dealers, where quality dealers deliver low prices every day. For the visiting Cleveland Indians, managed by former Red Sox skipper John McNamara, Alex Cole leads off in center field. Jerry Brown, the second baseman. Carlos Baerga at third base. Albert Bell is the cleanup hitter in left field. The catcher, Sandy Alomar Jr., batting fifth. Brooke Jacoby is the first baseman, hitting sixth. The DH is Chris James, batting seventh. Felix Fermin at shortstop and batting eighth. And batting ninth, the right fielder, Turner Ward. For the Indians, it'll be right-hander Eric King making his Cleveland debut on the mound. For the Red Sox this afternoon, the same lineup that has started each of the previous three ball games for Boston. Wade Boggs leads off at third base. Jody Reed, the second baseman. Mike Greenwell in left field. Jack Clark, the DH, batting cleanup. Ellis Burks in center field. Tom Brunansky in right field, batting sixth. Batting seventh, the first baseman, Carlos Quintana. Tony Pena is doing the catching and batting eighth. And batting ninth, the shortstop, Tim Nehring. The umpires, Larry McCoy, back of the plate. Durwood Merrill calls the plays at first. Tim McClelland at second, and Don Denkinger at third.
It is a mostly sunny but cool afternoon here at Fenway Park. We'll give you the game time temperature as soon as the first pitch is thrown. And the wind should definitely be a factor. At the moment, it is blowing in for the most part, somewhat across the field from left to right, but also in.
Well, it'll be, I'm sure, a welcome sight to Danny Darwin, who is really accustomed to pitching his home games in the Astrodome, in which, well, it's just Death Valley down there. So he'll take advantage, perhaps, of the breeze blowing at his back today. I mentioned in our opening about the Cleveland Indians being a speedy kind of ball club now. They do not have a lot of power in their lineup. Albert Bell perhaps will be expected to provide most of their home run production, along with their catcher, possibly Sandy Alomar Jr., another year in the big leagues for him after such an outstanding rookie year. They'll expect him to add on to his home runs, but mostly John McNamara has his ball club made up in a fashion that will not rely an awful lot on home runs. Turner Ward in the lineup today, certainly a speedster. Alex Cole, their leadoff man, a threat not only to get on base with speed, but to take advantage of that speed once he gets on base. And he feels like, as we said in the open, John McNamara does it, his pitching staff will allow him to be involved in those 2-1 and 3-2 ball games and wind up with their winning streak. However, they're going to have to prove that to me. They've enlarged the ballpark in Cleveland, also more around the design of this ball club with speed.
McNamara brings the lineup card out for Cleveland. Dick Berardino, the Red Sox third base coach, representing Boston. As we mentioned at the outset, this is the Red Sox 80th home opener in Fenway Park, and it is the 91st home opener for Boston professional baseball. The Red Sox have won their last two Fenway openers and four of the last five. Roger Clemens was the winning pitcher here last year against Detroit, and Mike Boddicker beat Cleveland in 1989. Red Sox opening the home season for the seventh time with Cleveland, and the Red Sox are 3-3 in home openers against Detroit. Both teams 1-2 coming into today's home opener. The Red Sox won their season opener in Toronto behind Roger Clemens, then lost a couple of heartbreakers the last two nights in Sky Dome. Red Sox did not get many clutch hits in that series. They hit just .214 as a team in those three games in Toronto. Meanwhile, the Cleveland Indians are losing 2 out of 3 to the Kansas City Royals at Royal Stadium, scored just 4 runs in that series, and they hit .189 as a team. Those numbers point to what you were saying. This is a team that better get good pitching, or it's going to be another losing season for the Tribe.
Well, there's just no other way around it. John McNamara's Indian ball club, I will have to say this, you talk about they scored just the 4 runs. They were facing some pretty tough pitching. Saberhagen, Boddicker, and then Kevin Appiah, the rookie pitcher in the American League last year. So wasn't exactly a ho-hum type rotation his ball club was looking at in Kansas City.
As usual, a sellout crowd here. Last year's attendance, 35,199. That was the best crowd for a home opener since 1969, and perhaps we'll better that here today as the Red Sox take the field at Fenway Park for the first time in 1991. Defensively this afternoon, behind Danny Darwin, Mike Greenwell in left, Ellis Burks in center, Tom Brunansky in right, Wade Boggs the third baseman, Tim Nearing at shortstop, Jody Reed at second, Carlos Quintana the first baseman, and Tony Pena will be the battery mate of Danny Darwin, making his Boston regular season debut.
His earned run average led the National League pitching last year, that 2.21 mark. The last 2 years pitching for the Houston Astros, this man has combined for a 22-8 record. 11-4 in each of those 2 years. And of course, he's operated both as a starter and reliever, and he can put that relieving role out of his mind now. Joe Morgan has every intention of giving this ball to this man once every fourth day now. And then, of course, a little later on, it'll be one every fifth day. Primarily, if you look at Danny Darwin, who uses a lot of sinkers and sliders, he has a split-fingered fastball and a circle change. You would think of Darwin as pretty much a ground ball pitcher. However, last year, the numbers were kind of reversed for him, and maybe pitching in that ballpark at Houston had something to do with that. You don't really have to concentrate and get a lot of ground balls there, but I would imagine he will keep his infielders busy for the most part working in a Red Sox uniform.
Danny Darwin is 35 years old, 6'3", 190 pounds. He's from Texas, born in Bonham, Texas, makes his home now in Valley View. And he is returning to the American League for the first time since 1986. He started the 86 season with the Milwaukee Brewers and then was traded on August 15th of 86 to the Houston Astros. The right-handed pitcher Don August and right-handed pitcher Mark Knudsen. Signed as a free agent by the Red Sox was Danny Darwin on December 19th of 1990. And the first batter of the season here at Fenway will be Alex Cole, the Cleveland center fielder. Cole was 2-for-10 in the series against the Kansas City Royals. He has no homers or RBI. Jerry Brown and Carlos Baerga to follow Cole in the top of the first.
Center fielder, Cole.
The first pitch of the season at Fenway Park. The ball well outside. Got away from Tony Pena. Shows bunt, and he is a speedster. Boggs is already into the grass third, and that long bunt brought him in even closer.
It'll take a long for Cole to draw a lot of attention to himself once he joined the Indians last year. In 59 games with the Indians, he hit an even 300 with 40 stolen bases, and their outfield is designed exactly to play around him. They'll let him take charge and utilize his speed to cover a lot of ground.
Ball outside, two balls and two strikes. Cole stumbled coming out of the batter's box in a game in spring training, hurt his shoulder and was sidelined for a couple of weeks. He's back fully healthy now and still up there at the plate with a count of 2-2. Fastball in. Tony Pena thought it was strike three. Larry McCoy did not agree. A full count of leadoff hitter Alex Cole. Monty Danny Darwin, a 35-year-old veteran, but would it be safe to assume pitching the home opener at Fenway in his first appearance with his new team, he would have some butterflies?
Butterflies come along with opening days to players, just like the bunting is hung out all over ballparks. They just go together. You don't get rid of them. Maybe after the first out or first half inning to work, you're probably all right.
Slice down the left field line. Long run for Greenwell. It's a foul ball.
See where Greenwell stations himself now. Most of the pitchers that Cole has gotten the bat on have been to the opposite side off Darwin. The wind really favors Greenwell to play a bit shallower now. Maybe not quite as long a run. And he has, now he's moving a bit more back, but he's a bit closer now to the line than he was prior to chasing that ball that Cole just hit.
Ball four, and the speedy Cole is on with a leadoff walk. Walks were the problem last night for the Red Sox pitching staff in their 5-3 loss to the Blue Jays. The Red Sox pitchers combined to walk 8 Toronto Blue Jays.
14.
Now Jerry Brown hitting .222 with Brown. 1 RBI. He went 2-for-9 in the 3-game series of the Royals. Ball one, low and away. Monty mentioned the excellent stolen base numbers for Alex Cole last year. In his limited time with Cleveland, in 63 games, he stole 40 bases.
And the Indians only stole 107 as a team, so it didn't take him much long, didn't very long to get to half of those. Or roughly half of them.
That was the Cleveland team record for stolen bases by a rookie, shattering the old mark of 26 set by Jim Norris in 1977. just underway. Cole at first, nobody out in the top of the first. The home opener at Fenway Park. Strike over the outside corner. Ball and two strikes on Jerry Brown.
Danny Darwin would much rather have had the lower pitch earlier to Cole than he ever wants that pitch up there for a strike. Darwin is not going to make much of a living pitching up in that part of the strike zone. But if the pitch down low that he didn't get earlier, he's not going to get, then that's going to bring Danny Darwin up into the strike zone where he does not want to be.
Cole's running with the pitch. It's popped foul and out of play, third base side. Cole, despite playing in just 63 games for the Indians last year, finished fourth in the American League with his 40 stolen bases in 63 games. Drive base hit. Cole had to hold up to see if the ball would be caught as it sailed over the head of Jody Reed. He stopped at second, and the first hit of the ball game belongs to Jerry Brown. The Indians threatening in the first with runners at first and second and nobody out.
Jerry Brown picks up his third hit of this young season. He's 3-for-10 now on the year. He waited nicely on an off speed pitch and then drilled it in the Ellis Burks territory. Alex Cole had the break and then saw the ball on the line. Had to hesitate, and because he had to hesitate, he can just move up 90 feet.
Two men on for Carlos Baerga, the Cleveland third baseman. Fastball backs him off the plate. Baerga hitting 182. He's a switch hitter. All of his action this season has been from the left side of the plate. He went 2-for-11 in that series against Kansas City. Chris James had been up in the third spot in the batting order for Cleveland over the first couple of ball games for John McNamara, but he's been struggling even more severely than Carlos Baerga. They have flip-flopped in the lineup today. James is batting seventh. Baerga's count, 1-ball-1-strike. Baerga just 22 years old. The Indians think his future is very bright. He bounced around and played a number of positions over 108 games last year for Cleveland. He came to the Indians in the offseason prior to last year in the trade with San Diego that sent Joe Carter to the Padres and brought Sandy Alomar and Chris James over to Cleveland as well.
Reed possibly not certain which set of signs Darwin and Pena is using. I don't think that they felt that Cole was giving away anything at second base. Jody perhaps got crossed up himself.
Runners at first and second with nobody out on the top of the first. No score. A 1-2 to Baerga, pulled foul into the Red Sox dugout. Might be a little bit chilly in the dugout in all of the shaded areas at Fenway today. 52 degrees, the game time temperature, and with the breeze blowing strongly straight in from center field, feels even cooler than that. Jody Reed got a glove on it but couldn't stop it. Cole's around to score, and Cleveland has a 1-0 lead. That's the first RBI of the season for Carlos Baerga, base hit off the glove of Jody Reed.
I don't think Rich Dower, the third base coach for the Indians, was even thinking about maybe holding Cole up. But if he was, once that ball ticked off Jody Reed's glove, he knew that it was going to slow it down enough.
There'd be no play at the plate.
Then for Tom Bernanski, Alex Cole will just keep it in high gear, and he gets the first run on the board for the Indians.
Runners at first and third, still nobody out. Brown took third on the play. Albert Bell, the left fielder, the cleanup hitter for the Indians. He looks at a ball outside. Bell had 11 home runs in spring training. He's hit the only Cleveland home run of this season. 273 his average, 3 for 11.
11 home runs is a pretty good year, isn't it?
Sure is.
Seems like every day you pick the paper up, look at the box score, he had one or two.
We talked about how successful the Red Sox were in spring training with the long ball, and a couple of the players shared the club lead for the Red Sox with 5 home runs. Mark and Greenwell had 5 apiece. Baerga has attempted a stolen base. It was an unsuccessful attempt. The only stolen base try for the Indians in their 3 games. Down the third baseline, pass Bogson into the corner. Brown scores. Baerga into third, and he'll be held at third. It's a double for Albert Bell. 2-0 Cleveland. And 2 men in scoring position with nobody out.
Now, this is a little more than butterflies here causing the problem for Danny Darwin. He simply has the ball up too high, obviously. That takes away a lot of the movement for him. And Albert Bell, like the rest of these Indians, when they have the chance, they are just drilling the pitches. This one all the way down to the corner. Greenwell has to be a little careful here not to let that ball get by him. Otherwise, there's another runner headed for the plate. If it is, they'll wind up at second and third with a pair of runs in.
Darwin started this inning with a walk to Cole, singles to Brown and Baerga, now a double by Bell. 2-0 Cleveland, runners at second and third. The fifth batter of the inning is Sandy Alomar, the catcher. And there is activity in the Boston bullpen. That pitch inside. Alomar claiming it hit him, and now Larry McCoy says it did. McCoy didn't give any indication until Alomar turned around, pointing at his forearm. But there is no argument from the Red Sox. That
and
loads the bases.
Most noticeably from Tony Pena. There's no argument on his part at all. He brushed him right across the forearm.
So the bases are loaded with nobody out. Red Sox pitching coach Bill Fisher is on his way to the mound. And it's a new look Bill Fisher for the fans at Fenway. He has dropped 32 pounds since the end of last season. He's also trying to give up smoking. The Red Sox bullpen was very busy in the 3-game series in Toronto, and Tom Bolton has begun throwing. Darwin ready to face his 6th batter of the inning, Brooke Jacoby. Strike one over the inside part of the plate. Jacoby now a first baseman primarily for the Indians. 250 is his average at 3 for 12 in the 3-game set with the Royals. He's still looking for his first RBI of the year. Infield back at double play depth. The 0-1 was inside, 1 ball and 1 strike. The outfield, as you can tell, just slightly around toward right. Ellis Burks a couple of steps toward right field. Low and away, 2 balls and a strike.
You've seen, it didn't make much difference so far what Darwin has done with his pitches. Just not where he would like to be with it control-wise. He's not missing by little bits. He's missing by a sizable margin, opposite side of the strike zone.
That just missed. And the count is 3 balls and a strike. Ball four inside. Darwin walks in a run. And it didn't take long into Danny Darwin's Boston career for him to hear the Fenway Bluebirds nearly in full voice. Second walk in the inning. 3-0 Cleveland. Baerga was forced home from third. Bell moves to third. And Alomar to second. Still nobody out here in the top of the first. And the seventh batter is Chris James, the DH. He's off to a rough start, 1-for-12, for batting average of 0.83. Strike at the knees.
Lack of control has never been a problem for Danny Darwin. Last year with the Astros, 162 and two-thirds innings, walked just 31. 89, walked just 33 in 122 innings. So he's usually around the plate.
He's ahead of James, 0-2. Felix Fermin is on deck. 3 runs on 3 hits, 2 walks, and a hit batsman. Bases loaded with nobody out. Red Sox still have the infield back at double play depth. The outfield straight away. That's just a bit high and tight. 1-2. Albert Bell, the runner at third. Sandy Alomar at second. And Brooke Jacoby at first. Off the end of the bat and straight back. Still 1 ball and 2 strikes. Strikeout for Danny Darwin, his first out recorded as a member of the Red Sox. He gets James looking at the called third strike.
Breaking ball nastily thrown by Darwin. Been looking for that pitch now for about 4 or 5 hitters and just couldn't get it in the strike zone.
Felix Fermin, the number 8 hitter, 1-for-9 this year. Strike. Darwin pitched very well in the spring. He had a record of 5-1 with an ERA of an even 3. He won his last start in Washington last weekend against the Orioles.
Well, he had one bad outing, and that was against his former teammates,
the Houston Astros. To shallow right, Brunansky with the catch. Bell won't try. He came about a third of the way down the line and wisely elected to stay at third base. Darwin could get out of this inning rather cheaply.
He gets out of it right now with no more runs. It'll be very cheap. With Fermin up and really a contact hitter and the wind blowing in, Brunansky played very shallow in right field. And because of the short throw that he would have to make to the plate, no chance for Albert Bell to even think about coming up that line and turning that into a sacrifice fly.
Ninth hitter of the inning is Turner Ward, the right fielder. He's 1-for-3. Spent most of last year in the minors at AAA Colorado Springs, where he posted that 299 mark. He takes a strike on the outside corner. Can't tell if that was a strike call or if Larry McCoy was asking for time. Now he's waving off the pitch.
Well, let's see what Larry McCoy is somewhere. Well, no indication there anywhere, so.
Strike, and then he looked down, and then he waved off the pitch.
One of the umpires, other umpires, must have called it sooner or later.
Sliced foul by Ward. Ward saw 14 games of action with the Indians at the end of last year, and he hit 348. And today he is celebrating his 26th birthday. He's out of the University of South Alabama in Mobile. 3-0 Indians in the top of the first. They have the bases loaded with two outs. Well, they had three runs in, the bases loaded with no outs. Darwin with a strikeout of James and a fly ball from Firmin, trying to get out of this inning at 3-0, and he's ahead of Ward 0-2. Meanwhile, the Indian starter Eric King continues to throw in the Cleveland bullpen. It's been a long wait. Straight back, still 0-2. There is Eric King, who will make his Cleveland debut this afternoon. He came over from the White Sox in the offseason, along with Sean Hillegas in the trade that sent Corey Snyder to the White Sox. Low and inside, a ball and two strikes. Ward was originally drafted by the Yankees, traded to the Indians. In 1989, he pulls that foul. And the ball boys along the lines in early season form. Interesting to come to the ballpark on opening day and see what minor changes have been made. Out in the bullpen, we had a shot of Eric King a moment ago. The rest of the bullpen crew now indoors.
Indoors.
They have enclosed the sitting area for the relief pitchers. It isn't quite as cold out there. Also protected from the missiles that occasionally come out of the bullpen, or rather the bleachers. That's a foul ball pass first. Looks rather homey. I didn't go out there before the game to check it out, but there they are, enclosed.
But those are sliding doors that will go left and right to allow the players to. I know they would almost have to be, because if someone were pitcher warming up and you wanted to get out and open up the doors, you're going to be throwing the ball right into the opening door. And believe me, it can get cold. Not only in these bullpens, in any bullpen. Wind is usually out where nobody else wants to be anyway. And it can get very cold and windy in there.
To center field, Burks drifting back and has room. That's it for a long Cleveland first. They get three runs on three hits, and after half an inning, it's the Indians 3 and the Red Sox coming up.
Let's say you're hungry, but you want to stay under 300 calories. You could try gumdrops, all 9 of them. Or try McDonald's new grilled chicken breast sandwich. A grilled chicken breast filet, ripe tomato, crisp lettuce, and your choice of barbecue sauce, honey mustard, or light mayo on a wheat bun. So when you're hungry but 300 calories is your limit, you could sink your teeth into watercress, several pounds. Or try McDonald's new grilled chicken breast sandwich for a limited time.
At Eastern Clothing, our long association with professional athletes has led us to specialize in suits for the physically fit man. Eastern Clothing, home of the athletic cut suit.
Alf's at it again with a comedy collection of alien antics. Alf's Guide to a Good Time. Now you can catch all the comedy classics.
Ever have a talking doll rip out your voice box?
So for a good time, tune in for Alf.
Weeknights at 6:30 on TV 38.
Eric King makes his first start of the year for John McNamara and the Cleveland Indians. He turned 27 just yesterday, so he and Turner Ward can possibly share the same birthday cake. Sean mentioned that King acquired by the Cleveland Indians in December in trade that involved former home run hitter Corey Snyder for the Cleveland Indians. The 12 wins for King last year in the Chicago uniform, a career high for him, and that winning percentage by far and away the best on the Chicago White Sox pitching staff. 70 strikeouts and 151 innings for the right-hander. And at one time, thought to be some kind of top prospect by the Detroit Tigers, and still could be that. He has an arm that is also very strong. He can get it up to the plate somewhere around that 90-mile-an-hour mark. But one thing that helped him as much as anything last year, the fact that he got his good breaking curveball in the strike zone more consistently. And because of that, those wins were there. Defensively for the Cleveland Indians this afternoon, Albert Bell in left, Alex Cole, the speedster in center, and another speedster, Turner Ward, in right field. Carlos Bierga at third, Felix Fermin at shortstop. The governor, Jerry Brown, is at second, Brooke Jacoby over at first base, and last year's American League Rookie of the Year, Sandy Alomar, the catcher for Eric King this afternoon.
The guest of Governor Weld is Vice President Dan Quayle. First home opener as governor for William Weld.
Fenway.
Yeah, the vice president enjoying some of the fine Fenway Park cuisine.
Number 33.
Wade Boggs to lead off, then Jody Reed and Mike Greenwell. The Red Sox with some work to do this afternoon as they find themselves in a 3-0 hole after half an inning. Wade went 3-for-9 in the three games with Toronto. King started into his windup, and time was called by second base umpire Tim McClellan. Apparently the right fielder Turner Ward is having a problem. Looks like it might be a glove problem. And it is. It's been a strange day already. Darwin threw a pitch that was a called strike, then waved off. Now King just trying to get the season started for himself. And as he was in mid-windup, time was called. Now he's ready. And he misses outside with ball one. Ball two. Wade has started the season with a three-game hit streak, one hit in each of the three games in Toronto. And he has reached base 9 times in his first 15 plate appearances. Jerry Brown throws him out. One out, bottom of the first, 3-0 Indians. These two teams played 13 times last year. The Red Sox won 9 of those ball games.
Three. Jody Reed. Second base, Reed.
Jody Reed. 2-for-12 in the series at Toronto. He was the last member of the Red Sox starting lineup to break into the hit column. He did that last night.
Jody's spring training started somewhat along the same line. Didn't go 3 or 4 days before he got a base hit, or only had one base hit, and then all of a sudden he turned the corner, and then they were coming in bunches, twos and threes for him. Known as a slow starter throughout his professional career. No, why? There's no way to figure that. Guys get off to slow starts in spring training, all of a sudden they are hot hitters. 2 days later, you start the season, they're slow starters again.
Jody,
explain that.
As a native Floridian, usually points to the cold weather. He's probably wondering what happened to those 80-degree temperatures here in Boston of a couple of days ago. Catch made by Bell on the easy fly ball to left.
39.
Two outs in the bottom of the first. The Indians lead 3-0.
And Greenwell, left fielder Greenwell.
There aren't many folks who like to hit in this weather.
Not very comfortable, that's for sure. One thing about being a catcher that you could enjoy, you could stay loose more so than a lot of other players, especially your outfielders who had to stand around on a very breezy day. It's tough to stay loose.
Mike Greenwell looks at a strike. Mike was 2-for-14 in the series against Toronto. What about this home opener now for the players? We talked about it as it relates to Danny Darwin, but Where they've already played three games, would they still have any butterflies for the Fenway opening?
A little bit, only because you want to do well in front of your home crowd. I think you have an extra oomph there to want to show the people that have come out in support of you that, yeah, I can get the job done, and, yeah, I'm going to have a great year. But the three games under your belt really takes a lot of the edge off when you get to your home opener.
I think we saw in the introductions before the game, these fans, only four games into the season, already have some things on their mind. It was a smattering of boos for Jeff Gray, who was touched up for a couple of home runs in the series in Toronto, including the one by Tabler that won the game last night for the Blue Jays. Joe Morgan heard a few boos as he ran out. These folks have high expectations, as do the Red Sox themselves, for 1991. But there are already some surly voices and angry faces around this park with the 1-2 start. Jacoby with an easy play, and the Red Sox go in order in the first.
Maybe a lot of that has to do with the fact that they're against their real rival now, the Toronto Blue Jays.
After one, 3-0 Cleveland.
What's in, Hunt? Funky chicken! Duck walk!
If it's out there, it's in here. The 9X Yellow Pages. Why would anyone need another?
No matter what they throw this season, we'll catch it. The Boston Globe Sports Page.
From the Far East to Europe. Across the Caribbean and throughout North America, only one airline covers so much of the world. So much warmth.
We love to fly when we choose.
Every time a Red Sox player hits a home run during a TV 38 televised game, you can win two tickets to a Red Sox home game and a case of 2-liter bottles of Pepsi. To enter, send your address and phone number, or excuse me, your name and address on a postcard to TV 38 Pepsi Home Run Sweepstakes, Post Office Box 500, Boston, Massachusetts, 02135.
Well, they can send their phone number if they want to.
Yeah.
Darwin's first pitch of the second is to the same batter he threw the first pitch of the first to, Alex Cole, who started the three-run Indian first with a walk, and he scored the first of the three runs. He's on base again with a line single into center field. That is the fourth hit
14.
For the Tribe.
Jerry Brown. Second base, Brown.
We both mentioned earlier how established Cole seemed to be when he came to the big leagues last year. Just a short order. He reeled off a quick 300 batting average, and John McNamara feels like he has the ideal man to lead off his offense that's built around speed and stealing bases. A lot of home runs on this Cleveland ball club.
Jerry Brown the batter. Cole running on the first pitch. It's a ball. Pena's throw nowhere near in time. Cole got an excellent jump, and he has his first stolen base of the year.
Very tough pitch for Pena to handle also. Looked like he may have had to dig it out. At best, it was a low, very low pitch. And because of that, Tony really should not have even made the throw because of the jump that Alex Cole had. Get it on the backhand, rushed it, the throw is low. Nice play by Nehring here. Keep that ball in front of him because with Cole's speed, he easily goes to third if he gets by him.
That's a good point, because many times you see the shortstop try to make a play where he'll stretch out from the bag and backhand it, when in fact with no chance to get the runner, just make sure you keep it in the infield. Brown singled and scored last inning. Pulls that down to Quintana. Carlos will play it himself. And Brown did his job. He moved Cole to third with one out. We're in the second. The Indians lead 3-0.
I don't want to keep harping on the fact that the way McNamara intends to run his ball club this year, but if you're going to play the way he has his ball club built, you have to do small things that Jerry Brown did there. Guy at second, nobody out. You've got to make sure you get a ball you can pull. Move that guy along. That becomes his responsibility. It's called textbook baseball, I guess, but if you're going to do that, that's the only way you can play. And you have to knock it down and throw somebody out on defense constantly.
Bayerga, single to right, driving in the first run of the game, and he scored the third run last inning. The infield is in for the Red Sox. The pitch is a ball just low. Little pop up. It will find the seats about five rows back.
I don't know if a day like today would bother Darwin that much with his grip. However, being a bit of a coolish day and a windy day, tough to keep your finger and hand with any kind of moisture in it, so you can grip your pitches properly. Of course, a split-fingered fastball would take quite a bit of extra feel in your hand to have that one. The changeup that Darwin uses is the famous circle change, where you kind of grip it with the last three fingers on your hand.
Ball again low. And a count of 2-1 to Bayerga.
Most of the fastballs that Darwin has used so far have not been of the sinking or running type. Maybe that's because he's had it up a bit and it stayed somewhat straight.
Fastball just inside. Bayerga went flying out of the way, but that wasn't much off the plate. 3-1 to count with Albert Bell on deck. Three runs on four hits for the Indians. No runs, no hits for the Red Sox. A runner at third with one out in the Cleveland second. Outside, ball four. Three walks now issued by Darwin in addition to the hit batsman. And that will get the Red Sox bullpen into action again. Tom Bolton was up last inning, and he'll start throwing here in a second.
The field bell.
Albert Bell doubled down the left field line, driving in a run. He made it to third with nobody out, but was stranded there. Darwin did well to get out of that inning at 3-0. The ball inside. Bayerga is a threat to run. Excellent speed on the bases. A lot of options for John McNamara. Both Cole and Bayerga can run. A little pop-up, Quintana near the dugout, makes the catch. Nice play by Carlos, didn't get very high in the air. He had to contend with the dugout that was coming in a hurry.
Well, this is a monstrous out, too, for the Red Sox to come up with, and Danny Darwin, and especially to get the cleanup hitter out in quite this fashion. Got guys on the corners with one out, and Darwin's able to get the ball right in on his hands and get the somewhat easy out that way.
Sandy Alomar.
Runners at the corners with two outs. And the batter is Sandy Alomar. He was hit by a pitch on the left forearm, it appeared. Pitch that just brushed him last inning. He was the American League Rookie of the Year last season. He hit 290 in his first year with the Tribe. Nine homers and 66 RBI. The ball low and away. Let's pause now for station identification. This is the TV 38 Red Sox Network. Breaking ball in for a strike. One ball and one strike.
Along with that Rookie of the Year award, I believe he took home the Gold Glove Award for catchers in the American League.
Slowly down the line, Boggs with a tough play, nearly ran into the umpire, and safe at first is Alomar. A run scores, it's 4-0 Cleveland. Cole came in from third. It's a tough play for Boggs behind the bag and a long throw, and Alomar runs fairly well.
Those big long strides at 6'4 frame getting down that line. This ball not hit hard. Darwin running that ball in on the big right hand hitter. But Boggs
don't
under
be
a full
afraid to move on Denkinger.
Dinkinger probably anticipating that Boggs could not get to the ball and didn't get out of the way. I don't think Boggs could have done any much more than he did anyway. He had to take a couple of extra steps and then a half step to get himself uprighted to throw, and that's a long, long throw from back there.
That will be all for Danny Darwin. Tom Bolton is on his way into the ball game. We're in the second with the score Cleveland 4 and the Red Sox nothing. We'll return to Fenway in a moment.
Team, catch it this season.
Hey, oh, let's go. The hall revved up and ready to go.
How do we get the truck back?
Throw it in reverse.
Let's go.
Hey, I know plumbing. I'm the one that connected these pipes. I know every inch of this sink, and I know when I'm stuck.
Well, Jerry, they don't make that setup anymore.
What?
But you can do it even better with the parts I've got here. And they'll last you a lot longer, too.
Yeah, I know every inch of this sink. But now, I know a little better.
You can do it with True Value Hardware Stores.
The Red Sox season is in full swing, so don't miss out. Get your tickets now and be a part of all the thrills and excitement of the 1991 season. For information, call 267-8661 or call the direct charge line at 267-1700. And for group sales, call 262-1915.
Tickets can also be purchased at the Red Sox ticket office at 4 Yawkey Way or at the Boston Red Sox clubhouse shop at the Burlington Mall. So get your tickets now and be part of Fenway Fun in 91.
This copyrighted telecast is presented by the authority of the Boston Red Sox and TV 38. It's intended solely for the private, non-commercial use of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Boston Red Sox and TV 38 is prohibited.
Tom Bolton working in relief here this afternoon. He was called up on June the 13th in the 1990 season, and surely put after that, he just simply dazzled. Going to a 10-5 record for the Red Sox, working primarily as a starter, and wound up a big part of their rotation by the time the end of the year came around.
He's on with runners at first and second and two outs. Danny Darwin gone after an inning and two thirds. And Bolton's first pitch is strike to Brooke Jacoby, who walked with the bases loaded to pick up his first RBI of the season in the first. 4-0 Cleveland. Here in the top of the second, Darwin an inning and two thirds. He threw 56 pitches. Jacoby with a fly ball in shallow right. Now the wind pushes it back, and Bernanski can't make the play.
This is going to be big trouble.
Two runs are in. Jacoby on his way to third. It scored a triple for Jacoby. And a 6-0 Cleveland lead as Bernanski battling the sun and wind, got twisted all around and never did get a glove on it. At least it didn't look like it from here.
Looks like he's right there under the ball. All of a sudden, there's a big gust of wind. Whether it came off and deflected off the face of the structure here, it was absolutely misplayed once Bernanski got fooled. He thought he was set there, and that ball just keeps going and going and going on him over his outstretched glove. So he thinks he's got it right there. All of a sudden, that ball picks up some velocity. It's taking off on him. Jacoby all around the third. Two more runs in.
Jacoby trotted for a while. If he had gone off in full sprint from the batter's box, he might have had a chance to come around and score. He didn't pick it up till he saw the ball land behind Bernanski. 6-0 Indians. All of the runs charged to Darwin. His line in his first Boston start completed. Inning in two thirds. Six runs, all earned on five hits. He walked three and struck out one. He also hit a batter and threw 56 pitches. The Indians sent nine men to the plate in the first, and James is the seventh batter of the second. The count is two balls and a strike. James with the first out for Darwin as the seventh batter of the first inning when he looked at a called third strike. I had James skipping out of the way as the ball landed in the batter's box. 3-1.
What a play by Tony Pena here. This ball going underneath the right-hand batter. First of all, he's got a good shot at losing sight of it. Look how far he has to go to get to that ball to prevent another Cleveland run from scoring. Sometimes when you catch and you have to say to yourself, that ball caught me. I didn't really catch it there. Red Sox catch a break. Pena with a nice play.
Breaking ball for strike two, a full count. James, the brother Craig James, the former New England Patriots running back, who last we knew was doing some television work as a sports reporter in the Dallas area. There's ball four. Red Sox pitcher threw eight walks last night. They've thrown four already this afternoon. Runners at the corners with two outs, and the eighth batter of the inning is Felix Fermin. He flied to shallow right last inning.
Felix Fermin. Got it down.
Felix now 1-for-10 this year.
In center field.
Bird drifting back, still going, and has to make a running catch in the triangle. The wind causing problems for the Red Sox outfielders. Burks a long way to go to make that catch. Three runs in the first and three in the second for the Indians. After an inning and a half, they lead 6-0.
When you buy a car, sooner or later, you're going to sell or trade it. And if you bought the wrong car, you're going to find out that there's a big difference between what you gave for it and what you get for it, unless you buy a Honda. Because Honda holds its value better than Ford, better than Chrysler, better than Chevy, and better than Toyota, which is one reason it's America's best seller. So don't be taken in by a great deal that turns into a great deal less. Honda. It's more than a great car. It's a great investment.
Come in, Condor.
One, two, testing.
The green monkey walks alone in the sky.
That's your signal.
Sir, two caffeine-free Diet Pepsis.
Sorry, we've just run out.
Order something else.
But I don't want anything else.
Just follow orders.
Look, I want great taste, but I don't want caffeine.
Sir.
I want caffeine-free Diet Pepsi.
Listen.
No, you listen. They do not all taste the same. I want caffeine-free.
Amateurs.
You got the right one, baby.
Right now at your participating Midas dealer, buy any Midas shock or strut until April 27th and get the second one for 50% off. That's right, 50% off installed.
Around the Horn is brought to you by your New England Toyota dealer. For Toyota value, it's the best deal going. And Around the Horn on this Fenway opening day. Yesterday, in his New York Yankee debut, Scott Sanderson had a no-hitter into the ninth inning against the Detroit Tigers. He lost it when Tony Phillips led off the ninth with a double. Sanderson the win in his Yankee debut. And Ricky Henderson needs one stolen base to tie Lou Brock's all-time stolen base record and two to pass him to become number one all by himself. Ricky with 937 steals and Lou Brock at 938. That's Around the Horn brought to you by your New England Toyota dealer.
Sean, I think this is a fine indication of possibly the win coming in this ballpark today. From center field and
hooking and blowing out. Fermin
does not have this kind of power to drive Ellis Burks to this deep a point in Fenway Park. That ball definitely had a little help from the wind, and Ellis Burks needed to get an all-out extra effort to get to that ball.
Well, that flag makes it look like the wind is blowing in, but we've talked in the past, particularly with this new structure behind home plate, that sometimes the wind swirls around Fenway. No matter what it is doing, it has certainly caused problems for the Red Sox. Jack Clark begins the Boston second against Eric King, the ball high. Clark 1-for-8, his only hit in that series in Toronto was the grand slam. It provided the Red Sox with their winning margin on Monday. Ellis Burks and Tom Brunansky to follow. King retired the side easily in order in the first. A strike on the outside corner, 1-1.
I'm glad you tagged Sanderson's no-hitter with the fact that he won his debut in a Yankee uniform, because pitching a no-hitter for the Yankees doesn't always result in a win.
As Andy Hawkins found out last year.
Not even a close game in his case.
I believe it was 4-0.
Similarly, the wind knocked around some fly balls in Chicago last year. 2-1 on Clark. He has just the one hit, but he has been drawing the walks regularly. He walked 3 times in the 3 games. Big swing and a count of 2-2.
Alomar is saying, wait a minute, we don't want to try to make a living up there with this big powerful guy up here with a fastball. You saw him give quick with the palms down, pushing in a downward motion for King to get the ball down. Won't get that pitch by Jack Clark very often.
Chopped down to third by Yerga. Wow. We're in the second. The Indians lead 6-0. They scored 3 runs in the first and 3 in the second. They knocked Danny Darwin out of the game after an inning in 2/3. Ellis Burks, 2-for-9
to this point this year with 1 RBI.
He hit 7 home runs
against the Indians last year.
5 of them in Cleveland, 2 of them here at Fenway. His 14 home runs for his career and 48 RBI, by far his highest totals against any opponent. 7 of his 21 homers last year against the Tribe.
2-0 the count to Ellis.
His 14 home runs against Cleveland, his next highest total, 8 against Texas. Cole makes the catch. You can see him look over at left fielder Albert Bell. Must be relief with the way this one is going to see that ball settle into your glove.
Well, he's had a little bit of a chance to see what maybe that wind is doing to some outfielders. I guess you can't play quite as shallow as we thought an outfielder could.
Brunansky takes the strike. Tom, 2-for-11 this year. Off the end of the bat and foul. He's quickly in the hole, 0-2. Brunansky undoubtedly welcomes the home opener. He's a .327 lifetime hitter here at Fenway. King misses outside, 1-2. This is the start of a 4-game series. Tomorrow, a rare off day on a Friday. They build in that off day right after the home opener to protect the crowd. If there are weather problems today, they can play the game tomorrow without losing the big gate. On off day tomorrow, on Saturday, Roger Clemens comes back against Greg Swindell at 1 o'clock on Nesson. On Sunday, we're back with you over most of these stations for Greg Harris and Tom Candiotti at 1 o'clock. And on Monday, the traditional Patriots Day 11 a.m. game, Matt Young against Charles Nagy, the product of the University of Connecticut, who pitched well in a loss to Kansas City yesterday. 2-2 now on Bruno. The Red Sox still looking for their first base runner. Breaking ball bounced well out in front of the plate. The count is full.
King has bounced around a lot for a guy
who has an impressive track record at the major league level. Started his career in the San Francisco Giants organization, has been with Detroit, the White Sox, and now Cleveland. He's just 26 years old. His lifetime record, 14 games above 500, 42-28. He's had a bit of a reputation for being a free spirit.
Free spirit.
In the air, in left center. Albert Bell makes the catch. One, two, three, go the Red Sox in the second. After two, 6-0, Cleveland.
Each year, the experts at Car and Driver look at over 100 cars.
So you don't have to.
From the current new cars, they just picked their 10 best. At the most, you'll probably only buy one of them. That's too bad, because two of the 10 best are Mercurys.
Mercury Sable?
And Mercury Tracer LTS. All this in the quality of a Mercury.
The thirst for adventure is Michelob Dry. Refreshing beyond the ordinary. And once you've experienced the bold taste with no aftertaste, there is no going back.
Dick Clark for Wish 99.5 FM.
Music sure has a special place in my heart. And I want to tell you about a Boston radio station you can listen to for hours at a time. Wish 99.5 FM. Wish plays easy favorites of yesterday and today. Barbra Streisand, Neil Diamond, Whitney Houston, The Beatles. And Wish always plays four in a row with no talk. Give a listen. Try the easy favorites on Wish 99.5 FM.
The Boston Red Sox and Kinner bring you starting lineup figurine day. Be at Fenway Park on Tuesday, April 16th, when the first 15,000 fans age 15 and under receive a Red Sox starting lineup figurine, compliments of Kinner. Order your tickets today. Phone the Red Sox ticket office at 617-267-1700.
6-0 Cleveland as we go to the third on opening day at Fenway Park. Tom Bolton's first pitch of the third, a ball low to Turner Ward, the number nine hitter, up for the second time in three innings. He ended the first by flying to center.
John McNamara has three switch hitters in his lineup today, the third of which is Turner Ward, so he hopes to benefit a little bit, as does Turner.
To center field, Burks started in and now a couple of steps back to make the catch.
Having to make some maybe late inning hitting moves because of those switch hitters. Turner Ward now looks like he's going to figure in the lot. Mitch Webster, who is not in the starting lineup today, also a switch hitter on John McNamara's club.
Alex Cole, he has been the catalyst for Cleveland as they've jumped off to the 6-0 lead. He has started each of the first two innings and has reached base in each of the first two. He walked and scored in the first, singled, stole second, and scored in the second. Strike, says Larry McCoy. One ball and one strike. Strike two. Cleveland was a bit fortunate. I'm not sure they really knew what they were getting when they got Alex Cole. Last July, San Diego, with some injuries to their catching corps, really needed a catcher. Called Cleveland and got Tom Lampkin. Jody will have to hurry with Cole running, and he beat Cole, who was out by a running step. Two quick outs in the third. Two teams talked for a while about who would come to Cleveland for Tom Lampkin and finally agreed on Alex Cole. For basically a spare part, Tom Lampkin, they came away with a guy who was a central figure on their club.
They wouldn't give Cleveland enough credit. Maybe they didn't know what they were getting. They knew they were getting a guy who could run, and they knew that for sure. And in some ways, this Cleveland club had changed over to a bit of speed last year with some of the players that they were employing. They had gotten rid of Joe Carter, who represented thunderous power, of course, on the right side in that San Diego deal earlier.
Jerry Brown with a pop-up in shallow right. Bernanski makes the catch. You can feel the fans holding their breath and a big cheer in mock fashion for Bernanski. The Indians go in order in the third after 2.5, 6-0, Cleveland.
Times have changed. So have cars.
Fortunately, Citgo has developed this new gasoline with HTA 1000 super detergent. It actually keeps today's cars running like new. So to take care of your car, fill it up with Citgo.
For a limited time, you can receive $10 worth of coupons on your next three fill-ups with an approved Citgo Plus credit card application. Take one and get 10 at Citgo.
My Celica? It's great. The performance is unbelievable. Plenty of power, great handling. I even saved $800 on an option package and got an incredible stereo system.
I love the way my Celica looks. And you know, even with the features I wanted, I got it for a great price.
Value? Hey, it's a Toyota.
Great resale value, too. Ready?
Let's go.
See your New England Toyota dealer today for Toyota Value. It's the best deal going.
The Boston Red Sox and Kenner have the starting lineup that you've been waiting for. Come and see the Red Sox battle the Kansas City Royals on Tuesday, April the 16th at 1:05. And the first 15,000 fans, age 15 and under, will receive a Red Sox figurine, compliments of Kenner's starting lineup. To purchase tickets with your Visa or MasterCard, phone 267-1700. Stop by the Red Sox ticket office or the Red Sox clubhouse shop in the Burlington Mall. So be a part of the Fenway Fun in 91. Order your tickets today.
Red Sox baseball is even more fun when you're part of a group. Come out to the ball game and bring your friends, family, or co-workers. Don't miss out. Join the Red Sox for Fenway Fun in 91. For small groups, phone 617-267-1700. And for groups of 40 or more people, phone 617-262-1915.
On this opening day at Fenway Park, the Red Sox trail 6-0 after 2.5 innings, 6 runs and 6 hits for the Tribe. No runs, no hits for the Red Sox, who are still looking for their first base runner against Eric King. They'll send the bottom third of the order up in the third. Carlos Quintana, Tony Pena, and Tim Nehring.
Great game.
Quintana, 3-for-12 this year. That's a 250 batting average with one RBI. There is one other game underway in the American League this afternoon. At Detroit, the Yankees lead the Tigers 4-0 in the second. The outfield swung well around toward right for Carlos, with the exception of left fielder Bell, who is more or less straight away. Alex Cole, the center fielder, well over toward right. Breaking ball outside corner. 1-2.
I mentioned earlier the amount of increase in the control for King of the breaking ball helping him along those 12 wins last year. Got a pretty good glimpse of it right there. What a tight, firmly thrown breaking ball.
Ball low, two balls and two strikes.
John, you mentioned the moving around of Eric King, and it is a little bit hard to figure out, and he is a free spirit. John McNamara says, I just let him go. He says, I'm going to give him the ball, and as long as he doesn't absolutely double cross me all the way around, he can do whatever he wants to do. A couple of his managers, Sparky Anderson being one of them, didn't go along with that philosophy.
Strike three, Quintana caught looking. We had a rare word or two from Larry McCoy. Carlos rarely says anything to an umpire, but might have been more upset about the previous called strike. It was a borderline pitch. This one looked pretty good.
Well, it's right in the middle of the plate and well above knee level, so Carlos really doesn't have a complaint on that particular pitch. Maybe it was about a previous pitch. No complaint on that one, however.
Tony Pena, 2-for-12 with a homer and two RBI. He looks at a ball high.
You might remember in 1988, Sparky Anderson kind of shocked baseball by sending Eric King down to the AAA level about the last two or three days of spring training.
in on the fists and popped toward the first baseman Jacoby. Two outs.
And it was more of an effort on Sparky Anderson's part to say, you're going to do it my way rather than me doing it your way. Sparky Anderson liked to call a lot of pitches at that time for his pitching staff, and still does to some extent. Eric King didn't go along with that. He felt that if he was throwing the baseball, he was the one that should be deciding on the pitches. So he and Sparky had a lot of pardon the pun, sparks flying in that area. And maybe that has something to do with it. However, Eric King with his 12 wins last year, that's one of the highest win records for the Chicago White Sox. But they traded for a guy who's really not a contact hitter in Corey Snyder.
Tim Nehring, the leading hitter among the Red Sox at 364. He went 3-for-4 last night. And after an 0-for on opening day, he's 4 for his last 8. The last few days have been unpleasant for the Red Sox, but Tim Nehring continues to be a big bright spot. Jerry Brown made the catch in shallow center for the third straight inning. The Red Sox go in order. After three, it's Cleveland 6 and the Red Sox nothing.
94 ways to love your baby. 16.
Make a fuss over your baby.
42.
Take your baby out for a night on the town.
94.
Fill it up. Ultra 94.
When your car's your baby, it deserves a gasoline as special as Sunoco Ultra 94. Because only Ultra gives you the highest octane under the sun with great detergency.
61.
Take your baby home to meet your mama.
94, Ultra 94.
When you're looking for a one-of-a-kind taste under 300 calories, there's this. Or this. McDonald's new grilled chicken breast sandwich. A chicken breast filet, marinated then grilled to perfection. Ripe tomato, crisp lettuce, and your choice of a barbecue sauce, honey mustard, or light mayo, all on a wheat bun. So if you're looking for a one-of-a-kind taste under 300 calories, there's this. Or this. McDonald's new grilled chicken breast sandwich. For a limited time.
Be at Fenway Park on Wednesday and Thursday, April 17th and 18th, when the Red Sox challenge the Kansas City Royals. Each day, be among the first 15,000 fans to enter, age 15 and younger, and you will receive a Donruss baseball card book, compliments of Leaf Incorporated. Be a part of Kids Week right here at Fenway Park. Order your tickets today by phoning the Red Sox ticket office at 617-267-1700.
Through three innings, the Indians lead 6-0. They have the meat of their order coming up in the fourth against Tom Bolton. Carlos Baerga singled, driving in a run in the first. He scored in that inning. He walked and scored again in the second. Bolton has pitched well since coming on for Darwin, who was charged with all six runs in an inning and two thirds. Bolton gave up the wind-blown triple and sailed over the head of Brunansky, but was not charged for any of these six Cleveland runs. He'll face Albert Bell and Alomar after Baerga here in the fourth. Chopped foul. While we have a moment, it hasn't been a very happy opening day for Red Sox fans at this point, but we hope it will improve and be a nice birthday present for Kitty Tierney of Cambridge, a longtime Red Sox fan and a delightful lady who is celebrating her 92nd birthday today. Kitty Tierney of Cambridge, happy 92nd birthday from all of us at TV 38. Base hit left field. Baerga continues to have a perfect day.
Hits just keep piling up for the Indians. That's hit number 7 now for Cleveland. Baerga, a pretty good year against Red Sox pitching last year when he hit 324 against them.
Left field,
driving in three teammates with 11 hits. Ball well stung on the line to left field by Carlos. Second hit for him.
And for the third time in four innings, the Indians have the lead man on. Here's Albert Bell. Fouled off his foot. If Bell and his spring training are any indication, he is bouncing back nicely from some problems with alcohol that plagued him last year. He had his 1990 season cut short when he checked himself into the Cleveland Clinic to get treatment for alcoholism. He used to be known as Joey Bell, but as part of his new start, his new life, his real name is Albert. And he has decided that as part of the new chapter, he will prefer to be called Albert. I certainly hope that all goes well for him along those lines. He's in the hole here, 0-2, and now 0-3. First strikeout for Bolton, the second for Boston pitchers this afternoon. One out in the fourth.
Albert Bell drew a lot of attention to himself, too, when he first came on the scene with the Indians.
He didn't swing at too many balls like that
and missed them. He was just a raw-bone, power-hitting type guy, and all of a sudden, he had so many mood swings that nobody could quite figure it out. Nobody could handle him, and they didn't know why. Finally, he let them know why. But I like you. You like to see, especially an individual who is willing to admit it themselves.
And those are the people who are usually the most successful
to get it turned around.
Alomar, the batter. And he looks at the ball too low, 2-0. Alomar was hit by a pitch in the first. He had the infield single on the ground ball down to Boggs in the second. That drove in a run. He also scored on the triple by Jacoby over the head of Brunansky. Chop foul past Rich Dower in the third base coach's box. We tend to lose sight of the fact that the Indians were a much improved team last year. They finished fourth at 77-85. It was their best finish in 14 years in their first year under John McNamara. He really felt that were not for some injuries to members of his pitching staff, they would have fared even better. They were in the race for a while last year.
John Farrell, one of those pitchers who he's lost and probably won't have back, maybe even by the All-Star break this year. They're not sure about where John Farrell will fit back into their rotation, but
he certainly did have every reason to think that,
well, they just gave some people some headaches in this division over when they really didn't expect to do that. And they did a lot of it with pitching. That's one reason they started this year off with such a high note on their pitching staff. Still have Doug Jones and Orozco.
Down to Boggs under his dive and in the left field. Baerga stopped at second. Alomar has his second hit. Runners at first and second with one out in the fourth. It's 6-0 Cleveland. That's the third hit yielded by Bolton and the eighth today for the Indians.
Sandy Alomar, even though he's just into his second year on this Cleveland ball club, I think he's looked at it somewhat of an instant leader. He's a guy that can kind of really help go with this ball club.
Sticks in his second base hit there,
just under the dive of Boggs' glove.
Brooke Jacoby, he's working on a perfect day. Bases loaded, walked, pick up his first RBI of the year in the first. Then he hit the triple that looked like a routine fly ball, but got up in the wind and went over the head of Brunansky. Two RBI with that swing for Jacoby. Started the day with none, now has three. Seems like every year Brooke Jacoby's name is mentioned in trade rumors, and every year he's right there wearing the Cleveland across the front of his uniform. He's now 31 years old. We haven't heard that he's going anywhere lately.
Kind of a solid, consistent type player. Not awfully flashy one way or the other.
Slowly to Nehring, and they'll get the out at second. Alomar forced out, Baerga to third, and save it first on the fielder's choice, Jacoby. Runners at the corners now with two outs. We're in the fourth and the Indians have a 6-0 lead.
Coming. Good game.
Shadows starting to creep out from behind home plate. They will be a factor a bit later on. Chris James looked at a called third strike in the first.
He walked.
In the second.
Strikeout was against Darwin. The walk came in his only at bat against Bolton. Strike one.
Well, the Indians had hope that an expensive signing of Keith Hernandez was going to answer their first base problems for a while. Keith was injured last year. Spent
just about the whole year on the disabled list.
And starts it on the disabled list this year. Just had some back surgery, I think, about a week ago. Not too long ago, I know. Sometime maybe during spring training, just prior to the start of the season.
So Jacoby's kind of made the move
from one side of the diamond the other fairly easy. Although he does not represent a big power guy as a first baseman.
I gotta think baseball's gotten away from that all around anyway.
One time your corner players, your first baseman, third baseman, were thought of as home run type hitters as well as your outfielders. Now it doesn't seem to be made up so much that way. Managers and organizations don't necessarily expect to get a high number of home runs from the corner players.
That ends the inning. James bouncing out with the fielder's choice. The Indians strand two. They have left seven men on, but after three and a half, they lead 6-0.
No matter what they throw this season, we'll catch it. The Boston Globe sports page.
Baseball isn't always easy, or painless, or pretty. But with two boxes of Kellogg's Frosted Flakes or Kellogg's Raisin Bran, baseball's free. Just clip the vouchers from the box, redeem them for a ticket, and you're in the game. Choose from any of these exciting dates. See package for more details. So don't drop the ball. Catch a free game. But hurry, this offer's going, going. Kellogg's Frosted Flakes and Kellogg's Raisin Bran, your ticket to the game.
There's a level of surface with which you're already quite familiar. Only now you can enjoy it at 35,000 feet. Delta's person-to-person service to over 270 cities worldwide.
At Delta, we love to fly, and it shows.
See some of baseball's greats at Fenway Park on Saturday, May 11th, when the Upper Deck brings you the 1991 Heroes
at a baseball game right here at Fenway at 105.
Immediately following at 3:05, the Red Sox will battle the Texas Rangers. It's twice the fun at Fenway on Saturday, May the 11th. Be here.
And order your tickets. Phone the Red Sox ticket office today at
617-267-1700.
This big and chilly crowd starting to get a bit restless. Red Sox bats have been completely silent through three innings. As Eric King has worked three perfect frames, he's working to the top of the order in the fourth. Red Sox leading at a 6-0 deficit. Wade Boggs bounced to second his first time up. He'll be followed by Jody Reed and then Mike Greenwell. King has made the Red Sox put the ball in play. He has just one strikeout. That was of Quintana last inning. Strike and a count of 2-1.
King winning percentage, a very good one of 750 last year, was third best in the American League.
Ball three, and it's 3-1.
Opposing batters allowed just a .237 batting average against the right-hander. He probably would like to have stuck around and seen that new Comiskey Park.
Pulled to right and caught by Turner Ward. One out of the fourth. Boggs now 0-2. And in giving up Corey Snyder, the Indians parted with a player whose performance had really gone steadily downhill.
Yes, Jody Reed.
He didn't seem particularly happy being in Cleveland. Now they've traded him and really improved their pitching staff, which was already considered the strength of their team.
Corey was an excellent outfielder with a very strong throwing arm, but he was a do or die guy. He hit it out of the ballpark or he missed it. Mm-hmm. That's all.
Of course, the White Sox are hoping that the contact approach of Walter Riniak will be able to make more regular contact in a White Sox uniform. Reed fly to left his first time up.
I have no doubt he'll improve, but he'll probably still strike out 100 times and only hit 12 home runs now, as opposed to striking out 135, 140, maybe hitting 25 home runs. But in order for Snyder to hit you 25 home runs, he's probably have to have a minimum of 500, 525 at-bats. He can get those with Cleveland, of course, but does 25 home runs help him that much with the little contact that he was going to give him otherwise? Probably not.
Down the line, foul ball. Very close play at third. Foul ball, says Don Denkinger.
He's the man with the best angle of all. He straddles that line. Jody Reed
pounds that fastball. It's in fair
territory there. Obviously foul there. And from our angle, of course, we have no way of knowing whether that ball went over the bag or not. But from where it hit foul or fair initially, seemed like it would be impossible for it to get foul by that little bit and not be over some part of that bag.
Yeah.
And I think you agree by the way you're looking at it.
Yes, I do. I thought it was fair when he hit it, and I still think it was. Well, at least we found out Don Denkinger can move off that spot, in which he failed to move when he nearly collided with Wade Boggs earlier. And there is strike three. For what was almost the Red Sox first hit ends in a strikeout. Two outs in the fourth, 6-0 Cleveland, and two K's now for Eric Reed. Not Eric Reed, he's in Miami.
Yeah. King has very much been a contact pitcher today. This is just the second strikeout of the 11 strikeouts that he has recorded. And he's had just one 3-ball count. That was a 3-2 count to Bernanski back in the second. He walks very few batters anyway.
Greenwell broke his bat and has the first Red Sox hit. He didn't just break it, he shattered it. Fermin went out, went as high into the air as he could on the run, but couldn't come down with it. And the Red Sox have their first base runner with two outs in the fourth.
Not enough left of this to give away as a souvenir, even with your name on it. Right off the end of the bat.
Pieces of bat flying everywhere and
just out of the reach of Felix Fermin. The Red Sox get into the hit column finally.
Bats have been silent virtually throughout the start of this season. Clark had the big blow on Monday. But the Red Sox had just 5 hits in the opener. And they've struggled to score runs in losing the last 2 days to Toronto. Jack bounced to third his first time up today. He looks at strike one from Eric King.
Following games in Detroit, they had the bases loaded quite a few times, but it wasn't by means of base hits. It was base on balls and guys getting
hit and then not getting any hits
to do anything about scoring some of those people.
King missed, and again, you could tell by Alomar's gesture, he missed in a place where Sandy would prefer he not miss again.
Sometimes as a catcher, and especially on the breaking ball, which I think that was, you see that ball going up in that area, you want to run right out and get it before the batter has a chance, because those pitches to hitters like Clark often will wind up in the net, if not off the wall.
Can you yell when the ball's
halfway? You'd like to, yeah, screaming ouch.
Miss it. Noonan.
It's almost impossible to miss those pitches if you swing at them, really. They're starting up and they just start to roll, and because they are hangers, they don't have particularly great rotation on it. So it's almost like a batting practice pitch, just thrown to get it up and over there somewhere.
Two balls and a strike. Ooh, look out, Dick Berardino. He went spinning like a top away from that line drive.
Season ticket holders down along that third baseline there from
where the wall starts to turn and go back toward fair
territory are really going to have to pay attention this year with Jack Clark when he's hitting. I have an idea he'll just fill that section up with souvenirs. Berardino now, what, a couple steps out deep of that third base coaching box.
He's now in shallow left.
You can't get deep enough, though, if that ball's got you in its sights. You can't move quickly enough either.
Fouled at home plate, and Clark clings to life at 2-2. 6-0 Cleveland. If you're just joining us, the Indians scored 3 runs in the first and 3 in the second to drive Danny Darwin from the game after an inning and 2/3. The first 6 batters of the first inning reached for Cleveland. RBI single by Baerga, a double by Bell, and a walk with the bases loaded to Jacoby resulted in the runs in the first. Clark down to third. Baerga was almost on the outfield grass, and he went the short way to get Greenwell and end the inning. The Red Sox pick up their first hit, but that is all in the fourth, and after 4, they trail 6-0.
Shine the lights on you, shine the lights on me. Keep your bud light shining for everyone to see. Shine the lights on this, shine the lights on that. Oh, shining all the others is with Bud Light.
When you're looking good, you want Bud Light. The clean, fresh taste won't fill you up and never let you down.
You can taste it, you can feel it. You know you got it right. Everything else is just a light. Keep your boy.
You'd better mark your calendar, because True Value Hardware Stores have a great tool at a great price every month in 1991. This month, it's a Master Mechanic 11-piece screwdriver set, including 5 slotted, 4 Phillips, and 2 Torx bits. In April, get the Master Mechanic 11-piece screwdriver set for just $7.99 while supplies last at participating True Value Hardware Stores and Home Centers.
Eddie Murphy's gonna make your May. Monday, May 6th, he's making trouble for Nick Nolte.
There's a new sheriff in town.
And Murphy's making out pretty well for all of 48 hours. Then, Wednesday, May 15th, he's making money, Dan Aykroyd's money.
Is there problem, officers?
In Trading Places.
This kind of thing happens to me every week.
Make way for Murphy's May on TV 38's Movie Loft.
Fans, this 1991 season marks the 50th anniversary of Ted Williams hitting .406. And on Sunday, May the 12th, the Red Sox will pay tribute to this Hall of Famer. All fans entering the ballpark will receive a commemorative Ted Williams assemblage folder, compliments of Nissen Baking Company. That's Sunday, May the 12th, as the Red Sox host the Texas Rangers. And, of course, tickets are subject to availability, and that should be a great day to see number 9 here at Fenway.
Felix Fermin grounded the first pitch of the fifth inning. One pitch and one out. Fermin, one of the few Indians to struggle today. He's 0-3. And it was 50 years ago that Ted Williams began his memorable 1941 season with a 9th inning pinch hit RBI single. That was on April 15th of 1941. One of the most memorable opening days at Fenway. The Red Sox rallied for a 7-6 win over Washington on Williams' pinch hit 9th inning base hit. He had a chipped ankle bone that limited him to 5 pinch hit appearances over the Red Sox first 6 games that year.
I spoke with Ted Williams this morning. His son John Henry was in the ballpark walking around with a portable telephone, I might add. I don't know why, but I'm glad he did, because I asked him when he had seen his father and why Ted didn't come to spring training this year. So he called him on the phone, and we asked him right underneath the stands here. Ted told me that he had some problems some things he was involved with.
Ward right back to the mound. Nice play by Bolton to spear it, 2 outs.
Those things that he was involved with required his attention, something that he had to be with in Florida. I think he makes his home up around the Citrus Hills area, which is over in, it's where the Cleveland Indians, as a matter of fact, are going to be spring training in the very near future. It's over in Citrus County. Tom Bolton helping himself here as he becomes a fielder. One hopper right back to him. Looked like a ball that possibly Tim Nehring would have gotten to had Bolton not flagged it down, but no point leaving with the chance.
And Alex Cole's had a perfect day. No, he's not. Pardon me, bounced to second his last time up. He was perfect until then. But he has been a thorn in the side. Bolton knocked him off the plate a bit with that first pitch. Now it's 1-1. Cole walked and scored in the first. Singled, stole second, and scored in the second. Bounced to second in the third. He's up for the fourth time in 5 innings. this season, of course, is the 50th anniversary of Ted Williams being the last man to hit 400.
It's also the anniversary, 50th anniversary of Joe DiMaggio's hitting streak, is it not?
It is indeed.
Six games.
Strike three. Holton blew the fastball by Alex Cole. 1-2-3 go the Indians in the fifth. Two strikeouts now for Holton. And halfway through the ballgame, it's the Indians 6 and the Red Sox nothing.
Okay, bring it forward a little bit. Keep it coming.
It ain't gonna fit, Charlie.
Just trust me. Hold it there. Just lower it a little bit.
Charlie, it ain't gonna fit.
Now, take it easy. Just be gentle with
okay,
it. It'll
okay.
be fine. Just lower it a
ain't
little
gonna
bit.
Fit.
More.
Okay.
Just lower it.
Sorry, Charlie. Just
take it easy.
I knew it wouldn't
Wait,
fit.
Wait, get it up.
Come on. I knew it wouldn't fit. No way.
If it's out there, it's in here.
I knew it wouldn't fit.
The 9X Yellow Pages.
Why would anyone need another?
You got the right one, baby.
You got the right one, baby.
You got the right one, baby.
You got the right thing.
You got the right one.
Everybody.
There's only one right one, baby.
You got the right one, baby.
With 100% NutriSweet.
Be at Fenway Park during Kids Week, April 17th and 18th at 1:05, when the Red Sox host Bo Jackson and the Kansas City Royals. First 15,000 fans aged 15 and under will receive a baseball card book, which includes a starter set of cards, complement of leaf candy. Purchase tickets with your Visa or MasterCard, phone 267-1700, or stop by the Red Sox ticket office at Fenway Park, or the clubhouse shop at the Burlington Mall. Part of the fun during Kids Week, order your tickets today.
We will be with you next on most of these network stations on Sunday afternoon at 1 o'clock as the Red Sox play the third game in this series against the Cleveland Indians. For the Red Sox, it'll be Greg Harris trying to even up his record at 1-1 on the year. Tom Candiotti trying to make it 2 in a row for the Cleveland Indians. That's Sunday afternoon at 1, and also remind you, Red Sox baseball on Sunday afternoons at home is followed by Sox Talk when General Manager Lou Gorman joins my partner Sean McDonough for a little talk about baseball. So keep both of them on your schedule and join us for Red Sox baseball and Sox Talk to follow.
Ellis Burks begins the Boston fifth. Red Sox with just one hit and one base runner through four against Eric King. That was a broken bat two-out single last inning by Greenwell. Burks fly to center back in the second. He'll be followed by Brunansky and Quintana. 6 runs on 8 hits for the Indians. No runs and just the one hit for the Red Sox. A strike at the belt, 1 ball and 1 strike. King 4-2 lifetime against the Red Sox. Burke sends one toward the wall and left. Bell looking up. It's 2/3 of the way up the wall. Ellis to second, ahead of the throw from Bell that airmailed the second baseman Brown and was backed up by Jacoby. A double for Ellis Burks.
The third hit of the year for Ellis, and that breaking ball just kind of rolled. That's one of those hangers I spoke of, and as I said, find its way in the net or off the wall. Bell plays it nicely off the wall, and then he just uncorks a very strong, too strong a throw into the middle of the diamond. Ellis Burks has the second Red Sox hit, and it's a two-bagger.
He's the first runner to reach second for the Red Sox today. Tom Brunansky, the batter. The ball low. Bruno fly to left. His first time up. 13 of his 15 homers last season here at Fenway. The other two were at Anaheim Stadium. He didn't hit one anywhere else.
The 5 of those 13 couldn't have come at a more opportune time for him or the Red Sox in that series against the Toronto Blue Jays, the penultimate series of the year.
If the Red Sox bats continue to struggle, and this is just game four, but they have been struggling to score runs, how much longer do you wait to use Mike Marshall, who is the Red Sox best hitter in the spring?
Joe has a tendency to be somewhat patient with hitters in that respect, Sean.
Brunansky, a weak pop-up back at second, caught by Brown for the first out of the inning.
And there's another way you can look at that, too. When you're not doing well with the bats, that's when you have to play your best defense. You can't give ball clubs second and third opportunities. I think we'd all agree that Bransky is better defensively than Marshall would be in the outfield. Now, how long you can let that string run, I don't know. That's strictly up to a Joe Morgan move there. But we have known Bransky as a very streaky kind of hitter anyway. Who knows the day you set him or any other streaky hitter down, for that matter, is that the day that the streak ends?
Right.
That's something you just kind of play with sensitivity-wise. But you're right. They can't keep going where they just have silent bats over and over without making some kind of a move, no matter what you give up.
Quintana, big swing and a miss.
These are bats, though, that you know are solid swinging bats. We've seen that all spring long. This ball club is really based on that, and they're going to get hot. You're not going to have them all hot one time like they did for maybe 8 or 10 games during the exhibition schedule.
The ball outside, a count of 1-1. Again, Alomar out to speak with King. They got Quintana looking at a third strike on Carlos' first at bat this afternoon.
One thing that made it a bit easier, or I should say tougher, on Red Sox hitters this afternoon was the quick 6 runs that the Indians were able to throw up behind Eric King. It takes a lot of the edge away from King. He can just kind of, you know, go back into a rocking chair now and work, try to make some tough pitches when he feels like he has to, but every pitch is not on a borderline for him this afternoon. Talking to Greg Swindell about that very thing before the game started and pitching for the Indians, I said, do you feel now that you have to concentrate a bit more with the idea that you probably are not going to get many more than 2 or 3 runs a ball game, depending on how your speed and how your on base percentage is going? He said it does. He says you feel like you can't make a mistake with a pitch or else you're out of a ball game. Well, that was taken away immediately by the 6-run first 2 innings that King was given. Kind of a belated birthday present.
Ball and 2 strikes to count. 1 out. We're in the bottom of the 5th. The Indians lead 6-0. Red Sox with Ellis Burks at 2nd. And 1 out. Fastball high. 2 balls and 2 strikes.
Speaking of Swindell, and I know you mentioned this earlier, he and former Longhorn, both of Swindell and Clemens, University of Texas graduates, they match up here on Saturday afternoon, the second game of this series. Boy, that would be, that's a ticket to own right there.
Indeed it is. Ball 3 low. And the count is full. King has not issued a walk. He has very infrequently been behind in the count. John McNamara, the Indians, the 6th major league club he has managed. That ties him for the major league record for most clubs managed. Of course, his last stop before the Indians was the Red Sox. Spent 1989 as an advanced scout for the Seattle Mariners. Fermin throws Carlos out, 2 outs, and Burks is still at 2nd. Dick Williams and Jimmy Dykes also managed 6 major league clubs. So now it'll be up to Tony Pena to get the run in. Burke started this inning with a double. He's still at 2nd with 2 outs. Pena popped weakly to the first baseman, Brooke Jacoby, his first time up. One of those times was last year for Tony Pena, when he led all major league catchers in games caught with 142. Fermin again. Red Sox cannot capitalize on the leadoff double by Burks, and after 5, it is still the Indians 6 and the Red Sox nothing.
Each year, the experts at Car and Driver look at over 100 cars, so you don't have to. From the current new cars, they just picked their 10 best. At the most, you'll probably only buy one of them. That's too bad, because 2 of the 10 best are Mercuries, Mercury Sable, and Mercury Tracer LTS. All this in the quality of a Mercury.
Budweiser cordially invites you to a party at Trump Plaza. Dress is casual. Punch will be served. And there will be plenty of Budweiser on hand. Budweiser presents Holyfield versus Foreman, April 19th at Trump Plaza.
Let's party.
The Undisputed Heavyweight Championship, brought to you by the Undisputed King of Beers.
Racers are prepared for danger. The probability is there.
It's driving with amateurs on the highway that scares me. Drive like a pro. Buckle up.
The Boston Red Sox Clubhouse Shop at Burlington Mall has everything a real Red Sox fan could want. Caps, uniforms, T-shirts, even Red Sox tickets, and much, much more. Visit the Red Sox Clubhouse Shop Monday through Sunday to get your souvenirs. Red Sox tickets are on sale Monday through Saturday, 10 to 5. And after all, you don't have to be a Red Sox player to dress like one.
Sean McDonough with Bob Montgomery back at Fenway Park. We are pleased to be joined by the man who had the honor of throwing out the first ball here at Fenway, Brigadier General Richard I. Neal. We talked about it after you threw out the pitch, and as you walked to the mound, the tremendous hand that you received that I think was not only for you, but everybody else who was involved in the operations in the Persian Gulf. Could you feel sort of that special warmth that we seem to feel all the way up here?
Yeah, I really did. To me, it was testimony or a standing ovation was in favor of the 541,000 plus soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines that we had out there. It was unbelievable. Somebody said you should have held onto the ball a little longer. They probably would have kept right on the applause. So it was unbelievable. Really.
Well, you were not a ham. You stepped right up with the applause roaring through the ball and walked off the field very quickly. But I'm sure that'll be something you'll remember for a long time.
Really well. And Tony Pena, you know, he came up and he gave me the ball and said, "It was a real honor catching the ball for me." So it made me feel good. It was really, really terrific.
Now, if only the Red Sox could get on the board for you and the rest of the sellout crowd here. You're from Hull, Massachusetts, we are told. I'd imagine you're a Red Sox fan.
Better believe it, yeah. My dad used to bring me here, and then I was a bleacher-ite during college at Northeastern University, so just walked across the Pens, and we were right here for a game. So, yeah, spent a lot of time out here. Of course, I probably should have stayed on the mound.
I think you're right. You threw the best pitch on behalf of the home team we've seen today.
Can you hit?
It doesn't look like I'm going to do any worse.
Can you tell us where you were in the desert?
Yeah, I spent all of my working hours in Riyadh, right in the capital city of Saudi Arabia. The other time, I did a lot of travel around the area of responsibility throughout the battlefield, up through southern Iraq and into Kuwait. So spent a lot of time out there. Yeah.
Jerry Brown, the leadoff batter, struck out against Tom Bolton, one out of the sixth inning. Carlos Baerga to bat next. The Red Sox trail 6-0. Baerga has had a perfect day. Two singles and a walk. He's driven in a run and scored twice. Tom Bolton has been unscored upon. He's done a nice job since coming on for the starter, Danny Darwin.
I know you didn't have a lot of leisure time while you were on your assignment in the desert, but from articles and a lot of pictures that we saw here in the United States, seemed like baseball did play quite a part in that, didn't it?
Yeah. In what respect?
Well, that's whatever leisure time your people had from work, they spent a great deal of it playing baseball.
Well,
they didn't have a lot of leisure time.
But that's right. If you recall, really a lot of prep time all the way up until the 17th of January when we kicked off the air campaign, and then after that, really everybody had to buckle down. But You can't just keep training and training and training. So leisure, the leisure time sport of America has always been baseball. You don't have too many basketball courts out there. So I think football and baseball were the two major sports, but I think baseball might have had the edge.
And we saw so many reports on the news, read so many articles that the connection to sports, that the Armed Forces Radio tried to send sporting events over there, and that the Super Bowl was televised even though it was on in the middle of the night. So many of the troops stayed up to watch the Super Bowl. I would imagine when you're in a situation that all of you were in, that connection to home, particularly with something you hold to be so affectionate like sports, can really make the time go along a lot more quickly.
It really does. Plus, it's kind of the link to home. You know, I think sports are embedded in American society, and I think all of us just by virtue of the fact of being, you know, whether it's our team that's playing in the Super Bowl or not is immaterial. I think it's just the idea of that's a connection with home. We see the folks out in the stadiums and stuff, and it made us all feel a lot better. And of course, if you remember all of the sporting events, the support for the effort out there at Desert Storm, Desert Shield, and then Desert Storm was just overwhelming. And you just kept hearing before each one of the events or during the events, people were just saying, geez, how terrific it was.
I would think that was particularly true of the Super Bowl, where so much of the Super Bowl pregame festivities and halftime were geared in tribute to you and all the other people in our services who were over there fighting on behalf of the country. If there's a base hit for Bell after two strikeouts for Bolton, but if you weren't aware of the feeling in this country, that might have driven it home.
Yeah, it really did. I was fortunate enough to be able to catch a portion of it, particularly the beginning portion when they, Whitney Houston sang the national anthem, and boy, she knocked the socks off of everybody. I think it was just overwhelming, the crowd reaction, sort of like out here, and obviously more people there, but the same type of enthusiasm and support for the folks out there in the field.
Runner at first with two outs for Cleveland in the sixth as they look to build on a 6-0 lead. And the batter is Sandy Alomar, who's also had a perfect day. He was hit by a pitch in the first, had an infield single to drive in a run in the second. He scored in that inning, and he singled to left in the fourth. 9 hits now for the Indians. Nehring throws him out. Brigadier General Richard Neal, thank you very much, and congratulations on what I know has been a very special day already for you.
Well, thanks very much for having me up here. It's a real honor to talk to you folks and to see our Red Sox kick off the season.
Anytime you want to come back up here, you're our guest, believe me.
6-0 Cleveland after 5.5 at Fenway.
Times have changed, so have cars. Fortunately, Citgo has developed this new gasoline with HTA 1000 super detergent. It actually keeps today's cars running like new. So to take care of your car, fill it up with Citgo.
For a limited time, you can receive $10 worth of coupons on your next 3 fill-ups with an approved Citgo Plus credit card application. Take one and get 10 at Citgo.
1, 2, 3. I'm driving back east on the interstate to a roadside diner and a sirloin steak. I best go west because I like the view. Nothing looks better than a barbecue. No matter where I go, I always go for real food. When I'm north or south, I pull up a chair, order a burger that's medium rare. No matter where I go, I always go for real food. Just goes to show, I always go for real food. Beef, real food for real people.
Show the spirit. Show the pride. Bruins pride. The Boston Bruins face off with the Hartford Whalers in Game 6 of the Adams Division semifinals, Saturday night at 7:30 on TV 38.
Welcome back to Fenway Park. As we head to the bottom of the sixth inning, the Red Sox find themselves trailing the Indians on opening day 6-0, and it is indeed an honor to be joined by the Vice President of the United States, Dan Quayle. I know this is a fun day for you, and you have a chance to come to a ballpark. Unfortunately, it has not been a very fun day for the Red Sox fans at this point.
I am bad luck so far, but I hope to bring the Red Sox a little bit of luck in the last few innings, because otherwise I'm not going to get invited back on opening day.
And we saw that you're enjoying the game with Governor Weld down below. You had a chance to sample the tasty Fenway Park cuisine. And we hope you are enjoying the day.
I've had my fair share of hot dogs thus far. Not only Governor Bill Weld, but also Governor Lowell Weicker from the neighboring state of Connecticut is over
to pay his respects to the Boston Red Sox.
And he too is disappointed thus far.
Tim Nehring begins the Boston sixth. Tim has been up once. He popped out to the second baseman, Jerry Brown, back in the third. Eric King has been outstanding. He's allowed just 2 hits, a single in the fourth and a double in the fifth. Now, this is not your first baseball game of the year. You had the honor of throwing out the first pitch of the Orioles opener.
I was down at Memorial Stadium in Baltimore for the last opening game of Memorial Stadium. As you know, they're going to move to a new stadium. As a matter of fact, I was just commenting to some people that the newer stadiums are going more for the design and the capacity like Fenway Park. Smaller. so everyone can have a good seat. In the new stadium, they're claiming that 20,000 good seats in the ballpark, compared to 7,000 good seats that they have right now.
Now, what sense did you get from the Oriole fans around the old Memorial Stadium? There are those of us who love Fenway and are attached to the older ballpark. There are others who say the old parks are nice, but it's time to make way for the new. Did you sense some sentimental value among the fans there for old Memorial Stadium?
There were mixed feelings. There were feelings of, gee, it'd be nice to stay here in Memorial. But on the other hand, they were willing to say goodbye to a good baseball park, a lot of fond memories, because they feel that the new park is going to be better for the fans. They're going to have a number of suites that will be available to people on a rather at-large basis. And I am convinced, talking with the owner, Eli Jacobs, that the fans of Baltimore will have much more enjoyment in the new park than they do in the present place.
2-2, the count, it remains 2-2 as Nearing sends one at the upper deck along first.
You know, Sean, someone was telling me that one of the problems that maybe the Red Sox are having today, and I don't know, is that they got in at about 3 a.m.
Yes, they did.
Last night, and here they are this afternoon. I can identify with that. traveling a lot, late nights, early mornings, and it's not healthy nor wise to have only a few hours of sleep.
Well, they did get in the wee small hours of the morning, having played in Toronto last night. There was nothing they could do to change the start time because it was a nationally televised game, and as we know, television often dictates the starting time for sporting events. Another 2-2 pitch, fouled away, Nearing battling King.
Well, I think we all pay a lot of attention to television.
Yes, indeed.
Those of us in the political arena included.
Mr. Vice President, did you catch any dialogue in Baltimore at all about the possibility of an expansion team in your home now, Washington?
Well, there's a lot of discussion about an expansion team.
Not favorable,
in Washington, D.C. Well, it depends. A lot of the people that travel to Baltimore, which is a good hour's drive, would rather travel a few minutes to a ballpark close to the RFK Stadium or somewhere like that to see the Washington team play. I don't know what's going to happen. Obviously, the people in Baltimore are not terribly excited because about 25% of their attendance comes from Washington, D.C., so that would obviously have an impact on their overall attendance. But we'll wait and see what the commissioner does on that. I'm glad that baseball is going to expand. I'm one of those that believe that there are a lot of cities around the country that would support a baseball team. Baseball is a part of our American pastime, part of our heritage and culture, and the more that people have the availability and access to it, the better we're going to be.
Do you expect that Washington might have a better chance because of the political influence of our leaders in Washington who would like to have a team in the neighborhood?
Well, the problem with the political leaders is that they can't get too identified with the Washington team, because once they get identified with the Washington team and not the Boston Red Sox, for example, the voters back home might say you've been there too long.
That ball looked like it was heading for the seats. Now the wind really carrying it back, and Fermin made a nice play to stay with it for the first out of the inning. Nearing battled King tough, but eventually loses that battle, and there is one out in the sixth with the Red Sox trailing 6-0.
Fermin, like a lot of the outfielders in this ball game, not escaping the treacherous wind here today. However, the baseball did not escape him. He kind of made a Ricky Henderson snapping kind of catch. He took what looked to be a tough play starting out and made it look fairly routine before it was over.
Is that what happened on that fly ball to right field?
Gust of wind.
Gust of wind got it.
Looked like it.
Because I noticed that they did not give an error. They gave it a triple. So I presume that something interfered with what looked to be a rather reasonable fly ball that might have been caught.
I don't know if outside agencies should be dealt into the scoring, but
well, if you want to use your considerable influence and go over and change the scoring decision, we have some time to question some of these scoring decisions here at.
I'm going to leave that to others. I know what it's like to have a lot of critics out there, and
we do too.
I think that I'll just enjoy the game and speak favorably.
Two balls and one strike, the count on Wade Boggs, the top of the order around now for the third time for the Red Sox. Boggs 0-2 today. He has bounced the second and line to right. Obviously, in the part of the country that you grew up in, it is unlikely that you were a childhood Red Sox fan, but was there a particular team you followed as a child?
There was another Sox club that I followed very closely, the White Sox.
Uh-huh.
That was the closest ballpark to my home. Comiskey Park was 3.5 hours away. I can remember many Fridays after school and in the summertime when Dad got off work that we'd drive up there, eat hot dogs, sometimes spend the night, and sometimes come on back.
That was a base hit for Boggs. Well, he now has had exactly one hit in each of the four games the Red Sox have played this season. That's three hits for Boggs. One in each of the last three innings.
Notwithstanding this game, how do the Red Sox look this year?
Well, we have been pretty optimistic, those of us here in New England who watch the Red Sox make a number of moves in the offseason that seemed to bolster the team. And then the Red Sox had a very successful spring training, one of the best records in all of baseball at 22-11. But even though it's three games plus into the season, the Red Sox 1-2 and now losing this one, you can sense in the park some moans and groans, and listening to the radio talk shows after their loss last night, these are fans who haven't had a winner in terms of a world championship since 1918, and they're feeling that this could be the year, although they're getting restless already.
Well, I hope they don't get too restless. Of course, they're probably spoiled by Indiana's Larry Bird and the Boston Celtics winning time after time after time.
Indeed, they have done their fair share of the winning for this city, and the Red Sox have found themselves regularly in postseason play, but they have been unable to win the biggest prize.
Well, they had it won that one year.
Yes,
they
did.
Very close, what, 1986, wasn't it?
That's right. 2-1 now, the count to Jody Reed. We're in the sixth inning, and the Red Sox trail 6-0. Reed is 0-2 today. He's flying to left and struck out. We know another pastime of yours is golf, but I imagine you, with your schedule now as vice president, you don't have as much time to get out as you would like.
I play golf infrequently, but I love the game, and I used to be a good player.
Yes.
I'd describe myself as someone that thoroughly enjoys the game.
Ball three balls and one strike. I'm not sure if you were here at the start of the ball game when Brigadier General Neal threw out the first pitch.
I was not.
Perhaps it was recounted for you. A tremendous feeling of emotion in the park, not only for General Neal, but I think for all of the servicemen and women who represented our country so well. And I'm sure as you travel about the country, you continue to feel that on a daily basis, the pride of the people in our country.
Well, you do feel it, and the people that I've talked to today just shaking hands on an ad hoc basis to say congratulations, tell the president he did a great job. You saw the reaction to General Neal. There's a strong sense of patriotism that it was nice to have a clear-cut victory, achieve the military objectives, and now to begin to come home.
Now, President Bush, is it safe to say that he is in a very loyal fan of the Texas Rangers, where his son
owns a large percentage of the team? He was down there throwing out their first pitch.
He was down there throwing out the first pitch, and he is loyal to his family, so I presume that the loyalty to his family extends to the Texas Rangers as well. Although he goes to a number of the different number of ball games around the country.
He loves baseball. He's captain of his baseball
team in college, and quite an athlete.
Mike Greenwell, the batter, with two outs now in the sixth inning. Mike has grounded out, and he had the first Red Sox hit. A broken bat single to left. That's an easy pop-up in shallow right. Jerry Brown makes the catch. Vice President Quayle, thank you so much. We know what a busy schedule you're on, and it was indeed an honor to have you here with us today.
Sean, thank you.
Thanks very much, Mr. Vice President.
Thank you.
6-0.
Good luck to the Red Sox.
Appreciate that very much. 6-0 in favor of Cleveland after six innings on opening day at Fenway.
When you're looking for a one-of-a-kind taste under 300 calories, there's this. Or this. McDonald's new grilled chicken breast sandwich. A chicken breast filet, marinated then grilled to perfection. Ripe tomato, crisp lettuce, and your choice of a barbecue sauce, honey mustard, or light mayo, all on a wheat bun. So if you're looking for a one-of-a-kind taste under 300 calories, there's this. Or this. McDonald's new grilled chicken breast sandwich. For a limited time.
Baseball isn't always easy, or painless,
or pretty.
With two boxes of Kellogg's Frosted Flakes or Kellogg's Raisin Bran, baseball's free.
Just clip the vouchers from the box, redeem them for a ticket, and you're in the game.
Choose from any of these exciting dates. See package for more details. So don't drop the ball, catch a free game. But hurry, this offer's going, going. Kellogg's Frosted Flakes and Kellogg's Raisin Bran, your ticket to the game.
Hey, I know plumbing.
I'm the one that connected these pipes. I know every inch of this sink. And I know when I'm stuck.
Well, Jerry, they don't make that setup anymore.
What?
But you can do it even better with the parts I've got here. And they'll last you a lot longer, too.
Yeah, I know every inch of this sink. But now, I know it a little better.
You can do it with True Value Hardware Stores.
Now look at the True Value Hardware Store scoreboard. In the American League, the Yankees lead Detroit 5-2. Island Gullickson, the starters there. Minnesota and Oakland just underway, no score. Erickson and Schau. Later on, California and Seattle, Langston and Holman. Milwaukee and Toronto, Robinson and Wells. We'll check the National League as time permits. Here in the seventh, it has been all Cleveland. They jumped out with three runs in the first, three in the second. Take a 6-0 lead, and it has been that way ever since. Off the end of the bat, Jacoby Tuneri. One out of the seventh. James and Fermin to follow. Now the National League on the True Value Hardware Store scoreboard. Los Angeles at Atlanta again today with Ramon Martinez and Charlie Liebrandt matching up. The Dodgers lead that one 4-1 after two. St. Louis and Chicago scoreless. Jerome Walton left that game with a stomach virus there in the second. Later on, San Francisco and San Diego. Houston and Cincinnati. And Montreal is at New York. Wally Whitehurst will be the starting pitcher. He won the Mets' fifth starter job out of spring training. What an honor to have Brigadier General Neal and Vice President Quayle. Vice President, obviously, a big sports fan. And James lines one into center field. He has a New England connection. A young lady who was very high up on Vice President Quayle's staff, Liz Murphy. From Hingham originally, an outstanding athlete herself as a track star in high school, Hingham High School. She was here in the booth with us and handles a number of events as part of his staff and advanced planning and public relations. I know her family in Hingham is very proud of Liz Murphy. James at first with one out. Fermin, the batter, he's 0 for 3.
I must admit, I was
a little surprised this morning when I walked into the booth and we were surrounded by Secret Service men. I knew the vice president was going to be
I just figured you were in
park.
Trouble again, Monty. I didn't want to say anything.
Deep trouble.
Yes, they obviously, for security reasons, Kanaski makes the catch for another mock cheer.
Fans getting a bit more grumpy as this
ball game progresses with things still not going well for the home team.
We did not know the vice president was going to be here
until we arrived here this morning. And when we took a shot of him earlier, we hesitated to mention that he'd be joining us here in the booth, again, for security reasons. Dane, a kicker, has started throwing in the Red Sox bullpen. Tom Bolton has been the lone bright spot of this day for the Red Sox. He has pitched shutout relief. Through five innings. And his first pitch is a ball to Turner Ward, the bottom part of the order, the only part of John McNamara's lineup that has struggled today.
Fermin now 0 for 4, and Ward is 0 for 3.
6-0 Indians in the seventh. That's off the end of the bat and foul. One ball and one strike. And passed Nehring, who was heading up the middle, then tried to reverse his field, made a valiant effort, but it was too late. A base hit and runners at the corners. Ward has his first hit, the 10th of the game now for Cleveland, and the fourth allowed by Tom Bolton.
Bolton already with an assist in this game with his fielding, almost comes up with this hot liner off the bat of Ward, then almost has a chance to get an assist, but Nehring, in an effort to move up the middle, initially could not backtrack his steps in time. It's by him and into the outfield. And the Indians continue the hit parade.
Runners at the corners with two outs. That is five hits now given up by Bolton. The starter Darwin also yielded five. Alex Cole looks at a strike. He walked and scored in the first. Started the second with a single. Stole second and scored. Since then he has bounced to second and struck out. He's 0 for 2 against Bolton. Took a big hop for Reed. He stayed with it nicely to end the inning. The Indians strand two. They've now left 10. Seventh inning stretch on the home opening day at Fenway Park. And it's the Indians 6 and the Red Sox nothing.
This is never going to work.
that.
Anybody can send them roses.
Excuse me, we didn't order these. Ian, what's this?
Hi!
Did they really expect us to call them?
Budweiser! I'm telling you.
Hello!
Nothing beats a Bud!
Pump it up, dudes!
The Turtles and their friends are on patrol, each armed with Don's sewer squirter, the Pump Action squirt gun with a 20-foot range. Oh no! Those 20 feet belong to the electronic foot soldiers. What will the Turtles do now?
Water down their pond!
Why, the water's shorting out their circuits! Who would have thought those sewer squirters would make foot candles out of Shredder's foot soldiers?
Well, water and a little elbow grease, they got anything!
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles!
From Playmates!
I just traded in that great deal I got 4 years ago. Now I know who paid for the big rebate and the low interest rate. Live and learn. That's why I drive a Toyota now.
And Camry's the most trouble-free new car in its class, with an option package that saved me real money today.
And value that's gonna save me real money tomorrow. Live and learn.
See your New England Toyota dealer today for Toyota Value. It's the best deal going.
This Red Sox game summary is brought to you by your local Midas muffler, brake, and alignment shops. The story of this game, pitching. Not very good for the Red Sox, excellent for Cleveland. Danny Darwin was roughed up in his Red Sox debut. He allowed 6 runs over an inning and 2/3. He gave up 5 hits and also had control trouble with 3 walks and a hit batsman. Meanwhile, Eric King is working on a shutout. Through 6 innings, he's allowed just 3 hits. It's been a balanced Cleveland attack led by Brooke Jacoby's 3 RBI. There's the man of the hour, Eric King. This game summary brought to you by your local Midas muffler, brake, and alignment shops. Jack Clark looks at strike one. Tag is over two. He has twice bounced to third. Burks and Brunansky to follow the middle third of the order against King, who's allowed 1 hit in each of the last 3 innings. He has not walked a man. He has 2 strikeouts to his credit. And as we mentioned earlier, Eric King has a long track record of success against the Red Sox. 4-2 lifetime. The only 2 teams that he has more career wins against are Baltimore with 7 wins and Seattle 5 victories. This guy likes pitching on the road too. So many pitchers prefer the comfort of their home park, but last year Eric King was 7-1 on the road for the White Sox. And for his career, he's 21-13 away from his home park.
All the Cleveland pitchers are going to like the new dimensions in their stadium by the lake, that's for sure. They've enlarged that ballpark considerably. 425 feet now to center.
Little looper, fair mean out, he can't get it. A looping base hit to the left for Jack Clark.
Now it's Burke. Center fielder Burke.
Well, the Red Sox have just 4 hits in the afternoon. They have not hit very many balls very hard off Eric King. Perhaps the hardest ball hit all afternoon was the line drive by Boggs and the double off the wall in left field by Burks. That ball a base hit, and it's a beauty, but not hit very hard by Clark. Just not having very many good swings at the right-hander.
Strike into Ellis Burks. Ellis has flied to center and doubled off the wall and left in the fifth. He is the only Red Sox hitter to reach second base today. We're in the seventh. 6-0 Cleveland. Late swing and a foul pass first. The Indians out hitting the Red Sox 11-4, and there is activity for the first time today in the Cleveland bullpen. That is submarine throwing right-hander Steve Olin. And the Alamo must have big pockets. That was a lot of plastic bag he just picked up. Fastball outside. 1-2 now to Ellis Burks.
Rest of John McNamara's bullpen made up of Bruce Egloff, Doug Jones, of course, their closer, Sean Hillegas, who came along in the trade from Chicago with Eric King, Steve Olin, who you just saw, and Rod Nichols currently is in John McNamara's bullpen. However, he will move into the rotation as the fifth starter when McNamara needs to go to that. Jesse Orozco is the left-hander for John McNamara. Kind of been a lot of birthday celebrations going on. Bruce Egloff, who was in the Cleveland bullpen, as I mentioned, had a birthday yesterday along with Eric King.
Mm-hmm. Birch pulls it foul. Egloff will likely be seen at some point in this series, and he is a great story. He has bounced back from
three
rotator cuff operations.
One, you're in danger. Two, your career is just about always over. And three, unheard of.
Three, you're a lefty for the rest of your life.
Oh, boy. My kid.
Nice play. The ball boy ranging to his right and backhanding it. 2 balls, 2 strikes to count.
We'll tell you the rest of John McNamara's makeup on his ball club. Bo Aldred, a
left-hand hitter and an outfielder. Joel Skinner, his other catcher. Jeff Manto,
who is a jack of all trades. He can play everywhere. Infield, outfield, he would be an emergency catcher for John McNamara.
Strike three, outside corner. Ellis doesn't like it.
With King's control today, and he's displayed it nicely,
he may, between Alomar and himself, gotten that plate just a bit wider here. Check the target.
And it looked like it could have broke back toward the plate, but yet did not quite get the outside corner. Alomar's glove didn't move back toward the middle of the plate that much to have that ball a strike. But when you're around the plate, as much as King has been around it today, you're going to get those calls later on or as the ball game moves along, especially when you throw it right into the catcher's target when he's set up, and that's exactly what Alomar did.
He's pitched well enough to earn those calls, and with two strikes, as we've said many times over the years, it was too close to take. 1 ball, 1 strike to count on Brunansky. He is 0 for 2.
These funny guys over here with these Sitco jackets on in our booth.
Well, people were asking the same thing about us earlier today. Line to left and caught by Albert Bell. A leaping catch on the warning track for the second out of the inning. Nice play. Clark back to first.
Bell not quite
sure of his location until the very last instant, maybe about the time the ball settles into the glove. As is the case with so many left fielders, he's off the ground. He has no idea how far he's away from that ball there. But he makes the jumping, running catch anyway. Hauls it in, and Brunansky is retired.
Carlos Quintana, the batter, he's 0 for 2. He looks at a strike. Carlos is struck out and bounced to short. We had the privilege earlier today of taping a commercial on behalf of the Sitco gasoline dealers of New England, in which we will be, well, we don't want to give it away. But I think it's going to be a big hit.
It's already a big hit.
Yes. Certainly the talk of much conversation around the batting cage as we were taping it.
Let's put it this way. The TV 38 hats they have on now
are just a step or two ahead of the hats that we had on earlier. We'll leave it at
yes.
that. How's that?
We will. Didn't take long. We raised the question earlier, when would Mike Marshall crack the lineup? He was the Red Sox top hitter during the spring. Quintana. King, let it go. He thought Baerga was right there ready to make the play. You could see Baerga point to himself as if to say, that's my fault.
looked like King thought he was called off the play by Baerga. Why else would he let it go right through his legs?
Well, with two outs, Baerga is going to be a bit deeper here. King really could have made the play, and for some, he said, well, yeah, he must have heard something. What he probably heard was first sound. May have heard Baerga saying, take it. But when you're the field in that position, the first sound you hear, you anticipate that sound to be, I got it. That's because that's what he's expecting to hear. So he just oversteps it, and Carlos gets himself a nice little, well-deserved infield single.
Tony Pena with a little pop-up. Out of play.
That happens so many times
on pop-ups with infielders, outfielders. The infielder is
expecting to hear the voice, and they anticipate that they're going to hear an I got it rather than a you take it, and that's probably what happened right there. Take it.
And King says, okay, take it. Go ahead.
The shadow's just now starting to creep out from behind home plate toward the pitcher's mound. Tony's 0 for 2 today. Ball high. Then had Alomar ducking awkwardly.
We mentioned that Tony's father, Octaviano, was
in Winter Haven, Florida most of the spring,
but today is actually the first time his father has ever seen him play
a big league baseball game, one that where the numbers actually
go into the books. His father is up from Santiago in the Dominican Republic to watch Tony for the first time. Tony told me, oddly enough, he said, my father was not an athlete. He was not a baseball player in the Dominican Republic. He says my mother was, and she was quite
a good softball player.
But Tony very happy to have his father with him all spring long, and of course he'll be with him for a good part of the summer.
Tony out ahead of it. The wind's trying to bring it back. The wind's still blowing it toward the corner, and it's dropped by Bell. That wind brought that ball way back into play. Two-run score, and the Red Sox are on the board at 6-2. Well, that left the bat, it looked like it would be up on the roof over the luxury boxes. And the wind kept pushing it, and it landed in the corner beyond the grasp of Albert Bell. It scored a double for Pena, and the Red Sox are within four.
Combination of this ball being blown back and Bell overrunning it winds up with the ball
not being handled. What could have been out number three will keep the inning alive, and a couple runs in for Boston.
That ball just simply blew right back over the head of Albert Bell into play. Pena thought when he originally left the bat it was going to be well up on the roof and out of play.
Looking at it now, Bell
chasing it. Tony's still not
sure exactly what happened. He pauses between first and
second. He'll wind up at second. Red Sox get on a board with a pair of runs on a misplay once again caused by the wind here at Fenway.
And an unfortunate sequence of events for Eric King, who has pitched brilliantly, but he leaves now having lost his shutout, but still leading 6-2. We'll return to Fenway in a moment.
What makes you cool is your attitude,
your inner self.
It's not the way your hair is cut. It's not the clothes you wear.
Not the clothes.
Not the clothes.
It's not what you drink.
You got that right.
You got Pepsi for me?
Who knew?
Train arriving on track 4 for Grand Central Station, making stops at New Haven, Bridgeport, Westport, Stamford, Sheridan, Costco.
If it's out there, it's in here. The 9X Yellow Pages. Why would anyone need another?
Each year, the experts at Car and Driver look at over 100 cars, so you don't have to. From the current new cars, they just picked their 10 best. At the most, you'll probably only buy one of them. That's too bad, because two of the 10 best are Mercury's. Mercury Sable and Mercury Tracer LTS. All this in the quality of a Mercury.
Today's game is brought to you in part by Toyota. For Toyota value, it's the best deal going. And by Diet Pepsi, the right one, baby. Uh-huh.
Submariner Steve Olin on now. This is his first appearance of the year. Made this Cleveland ball club last year out of spring training. He was simply invited there and pitched his way right onto the team.
Pitching to Tim Nehring.
With Pena at second. Up the middle, base hit. Pena being waved in. He will score. And the Red Sox have cut the lead in half. It's now 6-3. Another big hit in the young season for Tim Nehring.
Tim Nehring, as a rookie batting in that 10th spot, has been quoted as saying he knows he's going to get the opportunity to drive some runners in because of the people that bat in front of him in that order. He says, I simply have to take advantage of it. Well, he's done that the last couple of ball games. Two RBI for him yesterday, and right here, a big run driven in with two outs, and the Red Sox taking advantage of some Cleveland misplays.
As the Indians did earlier, taking advantage of some Red Sox miscues. Boggs takes a strike. Wade single to left his last time up. He's 1-for-3 today. Four of the 7 Boston hits here in the 7th inning. Strike 2.
Pittsburgh's still with a sizable hill to climb, but we mentioned this a couple times in spring training. I feel that with their lineup now, and especially with the addition of Clark, if they're within 3 runs of anybody from the 7th inning on in ball games, they're right in the middle of it. I mean, they're very much in it.
Don't forget the performance of Tom Bolton. If he did not come in and shut down the Indians completely, this wouldn't be a ball game.
Check swing and a ball low and away. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 outs. Nearing it first in the 7th. 3 runs into this frame for the Red Sox.
Got the 6-0 lead to 6-3. 2-2 pitch. Foul tip. Alomar couldn't squeeze it.
Boggs just barely alive.
Tough any time to get the foul tip where Alomar gets it. He gets it right up on the heel of the glove. Watch him turn the glove over. And then, ouch.
That is well away from the
pocket. It's right into the really the fleshy part of your hand. And it'll sting for quite some time.
And the 2-2, pulled to right. Ward started back, now in to make the catch. Red Sox come up with 3 runs in the 7th. And after 7, it's Cleveland 6 and Boston 3.
What do you think?
Here's a better idea.
Welcome aboard.
Welcome to the Bermuda Triangle.
No wonder nobody ever comes back.
You watch TV 38 Sports, now you can wear it with Watch and Wear from TV 38. Here's a Heather
on 5 pitches.
Carlos Baerga. Good play.
Carlos Baerga.
2-for-3. 2 singles and a walk.
He's also struck out. He's driven in a run and scored twice. Showed bunt. Took a ball low and inside. Kicker had more success against Cleveland last year than any other opponent. Dana 8-9, as you saw for the season, but his record against the Tribe was 3-0. In 19 innings against the Indians last year, he allowed just 2 earned runs. Good punt. Quintana has to go to first to
Reed covering. Sacrifice 3 for the scoring.
And in a scoring position, Jerry Brown with 1 out.
Indian ball club will play for that 1 extra run here, and John McNamara looking at it from the standpoint, he saw so many things happen in this ballpark when he managed here, the size of it. Trying to get that pad run here in the eighth inning.
Cleanup hitter, Albert Bell, 2-for-4, an RBI double in the first. He singled the left in the sixth. Strike over the outside part of the plate. Bell's just 24 years old. He's from Shreveport, Louisiana. It was the Indians' second round pick in the June 1987 draft. He's in the hole 0-2. Bell spent 3 years in the fine baseball program at Louisiana State.
He has been continuing his studies at Cleveland State University.
One and three. Well, and after
the slider that looked to be a little bit
out of the strike zone, that was
the most effective pitch for Dana Kicker a year ago.
That is no question his best pitch, Sean. The slider that looks like it starts on the outer
the third of the plate and then just continues to bite and dive out of the strike zone.
It looks
so enticing to a right-handed hitter, a strong right-handed hitter, who likes to extend their arms anyway.
They go for it, as Bell did, but
it's no longer there.
So now two outs and a runner at second. The batter, Sandy Alomar, the catcher. He took ball one inside. Alomar hit by a pitch in the first.
He singled a drive and a run in the second. He also scored in an inning. He singled again to left in the fourth, and he bounced to short in the sixth.
The Indians batting in the eighth with a 6-3 lead. One ball and one strike. Jerry Brown, the runner at second. Chopper foul past third. Sandy Alomar not only was the Rookie of the Year last year, but he was the unanimous choice by the Baseball Writers of America. He's also named the top rookie in the American League by the Sporting News, Baseball America, USA Today, Sports Illustrated, and CNN. I would say most of America agreed he was the best rookie in the league last year. He was only the third player to be unanimously selected the Rookie of the Year in the American League since its inception in 1947.
I know one of them.
Yes, you do.
The other was a catcher, too.
Carlton Fisk in 1972. Would you like to take a stab at the other? Tough to, that would be a tough
one. I'll tell you, it's probably somebody that you haven't Kurt Blepper.
No, it's actually in very recent times. Within the last 5 years. Mark McGuire in 1987. Strike three. Two strikeouts in the inning for a Kicker. After 7.5 on opening day at Fenway Park, the Indians 6 and the Red Sox 3.
Let's say you're hungry.